With InfoWars.com. Now today we've decided to come out to the University of Texas in Austin and quiz students and find out if they actually know anything about this upcoming Independence holiday. You know what holiday we're celebrating this weekend?
Yeah, 4th of July.
Have no idea.
What?
July 4th, man.
I don't. Oh, 4th of July. Right?
Well, that's a day though. What's the holiday?
What?
No, I don't.
Good for you.
Probably July 4th.
Yeah, that's probably. It comes after the 3rd.
4th of July.
But what's the holiday called?
Independence Day.
There you go. And you know who we're celebrating our independence from? What tyrannical government?
Enlighten me.
You got to tell me.
I got to tell you. Well, wait a minute now.
Independence Day.
There you go.
Yeah.
And who are we celebrating our independence from? You guys don't know? Are you going to be celebrating this holiday? Do you know why? And who are we celebrating our independence from?
Britain.
Damn British.
There you go. And what kind of coats did they wear?
Red.
Yeah, they're red coats.
Do you like those coats?
No, I think they're ugly as anything.
Great Britain. Britain.
What? Look at you.
Britain. Great Britain.
I'm from Mexico, so I know nothing.
We're all from Mexico.
Let me think. Oh, man. Our independence. Isn't it Mexico or is Mexico or Spain, isn't it?
I'm going to say Mexico.
You put me on the spot.
Okay, I'll give you a couple choices if you want. You ready?
Okay, give me some choices.
China?
No.
Mexico?
Yes.
Great Britain?
No.
Okay.
Okay.
And what year did we declare independence?
19... Is that right? Am I right? 1980s?
You're getting close.
Is that right? 1989?
It's 1989 from Mexico. What?
I don't know, man.
1600s, 1700s, 1800s,
1600s. 1900s.
Okay, 1600s.
Oh, man. Yeah, I can't.
1776.
That's what I'm talking about. Let me get a high five real quick.
1744.
Okay.
1744?
Is it? Yeah.
I'm letting you answer.
I think it's 1744.
Okay.
1796.
No, 1776. That's what I meant.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's when my university was founded, so I get the two confused.
Two important dates. Yeah.
Do you know what year we got our independence?
Oh, no. I don't.
Okay.
1776.
There you go.
A long time ago.
1600s, 1700s, 1800s, 1900s?
1600s.
Okay, give me a day then.
Or 1776.
There you go.
It was like, I don't know, 1925? I don't know.
All right. And what document did we write and come up with on the
Declaration of Independence?
So you're saying that sarcastically, but you have to understand there's a lot of people who keep saying Mexico and things like that.
Really?
Who are from here, yeah.
I have no idea.
It's already got the name in it, kind of. It's got to add a couple other things.
The Declaration of Independence.
You got that one.
The American Constitution.
Okay.
No. The Constitution.
And it's called the Independence. It's Independence Day, so what goes before Independence to make this?
Declaration of Independence.
There you go.
Thank you.
Declaration of Independence.
Okay, do you know any of the names of the people who signed it?
John Hancock was the first one.
She knows all the governments.
Well, you got any other names?
Yeah, Thomas Jefferson, Benjamin Franklin, all the founding fathers. You know, right? Don't you know?
Look at this.
Yeah.
I remember Thomas or something like that. I don't know. Who's the guy who wore like the hat? No, he died. Never mind. No, I don't. I don't have no idea.
James Madison, George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, Benjamin Franklin, maybe.
Look at this guy. He used to say where you're from one more time.
Saudi Arabia.
Well, I mean, I know that it was authored by Thomas Jefferson, who is also the founder of the University of Virginia, one of the most important universities in this country. But yeah, I suppose John Hancock, a bunch of other dudes. I should know. I watched National Treasure a lot.
You know any of the people who signed it in 1989 from Mexico?
Thomas Jefferson. Right?
Yeah.
And George Washington.
You're on it. There's no fooling you. Look at you.
We'll be back. All of our basic freedoms are under sustained attack, not just here in the United States, but all over the world. But in its place, they're replacing our basic liberties with ninnying rights to be politically correct. And obsess over destroying the right to language, the right to property, the right to our bodies. California vaccine bill battle erupts into all-out political war. There are major recall movements starting to remove members of the California House and Senate that passed a forced inoculation bill for school children. And now, they have doubled down with two more bills to forcibly inoculate adults. They're not going to stop. And that's healthcare workers, and then anyone who's in contact with children. That'll be everybody. This is forced inoculation. You're like, well, I'll just leave California. Oh, really? You will. California is the model state for the takedown of the United States, along with New York, who's got forced inoculation bills advancing in their legislature. All over a few hundred measles cases where no one died. In fact, what smart people do, and what pediatricians, a lot of them privately do, they don't vaccinate their kids. One of the highest levels of unvaccinated is one of their kids will get the measles. They'll invite their neighbors over and others for a measles party so that the kids get it when their immune system isn't already run down. And so you barely even get a couple spots on your face and get 101 fever for a day. But they take normal things and basically make it like it's the end of the world. It's a victory of hype and hysteria. Honeybees kill a couple hundred. Wasps kill hundreds. Water moccasins kill hundreds. Deer physically kill more than 10 people a year, ramming them with their antlers. Deer attack people. Elk attack and kill people. They kill hundreds jumping in front of your cars. But you're not scared of deer. You're scared of sharks that kill 5 to 10 people a year worldwide. And again, I go back to these examples because they're so key. But regardless of that, there's a whole nother debate about the vaccines. Most of the so-called vaccines are not classical vaccines where you take smallpox and kill it, or you take a virus and go in and radiate it, or however you break it, and then you put that in and the body learns how to respond to it, basically fighting a dummy. It's like training an attack dog, you know, on a dummy. These new vaccines aren't vaccines. See, everything is playing on the public's ignorance. We sent Joe Biggs out yesterday in Austin, Texas, in a red, white, and blue suit, our reporter. The video's on Infowars.com. I'm going to have it added under the article that's on drudgereport.com. Citizens don't know what country we seceded from in 1776. And about 60% of the Austinites we talked to had no idea what Independence Day was even about. Those that did know, the 4 out of 10 or so, most of them had spotty knowledge. A few of them had very good knowledge. But you have to understand, if you get 60% of the public that don't know what Independence Day is, and they just hear, oh, people are getting measles, got to have a law to make everybody take shots. California is now mandating more than 20 vaccines. It's whatever the health department mandates, they then say is mandatory. Without a law, they engaged in fraud for decades all over this country and in Europe and Australia, saying it was the law when they had a waiver in their filing cabinet. And federal funding to the schools is tied more than anything, not to test scores. No Child Left Behind, which is federalization, but it is tied to test scores. It's more tied to vaccination records and school attendance. The money's tied to those two things. You can fail your test scores for 3-4 years and not get your funding taken away. But you have attendance drop or you don't vaccinate over 98%, your money is revoked. Same thing with the TSA announcing. There's no law. They couldn't pass the Real ID Act fully. They passed part of it where they make the states adopt all the federal guidelines. So now they're just saying you can't fly with a state ID if your state doesn't comply with the feds. And then see, next, the feds can attach to having the state be under their federal auspices and the ID cards working and being accepted. That's the cashless society. That's an internal passport. That's a mark to buy and sell. The ultimate slave item. You see, slaves in ancient Rome and other areas had to carry little necklaces around their neck, wood or copper or iron, stating who owned them, and they had to carry a piece of paper with them on the business they were on with a seal. And if you got caught with a fake seal or a fake letter, it was death in the arena. Or you were sent to a lead mine, or a salt mine, or a copper mine, or a gold mine to be worked to death. So all the new stuff we're getting, we've seen it before. You see, and when they have these newscasts, it's like, it's so wonderful. It's so easy to that Colorado complied with the federal government. And now this lady who's not allowed to fly with her old license, she can go get a new one now and she's allowed to fly. And the TSA guy goes, well, you don't have to get it. You just can't fly, and starts laughing. Ha, 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 ha. And you can buy nor sell without it when they're done. They have announced, all the major think tanks decades ago, that you're going to have an ID card and a face scan and a thumbprint. You're going to put your hand down to buy and sell. All the new software coming out that deals with the internet from Microsoft, Google, Apple, you name it, has embedded already the thumbprint activation systems. You see most people with their droids and with their iPhones accessing them by thumbprint right now. You're like, oh, it's convenient, oh, it's fun, oh, it's easy. Yeah, but then that once it's ubiquitous, they're going to attach it to track everything you do and make any transaction not tracked illegal. And then they could turn your digital number off and you will be done. And then, of course, the next move is purchasing by retina scan, face scan, or voice print. This has all been announced. Just like I told you, they're coming with forced inoculation. Now it's here. Here it is, Fox News. I was on syndicated radio shows, TV interviews, you name it, in the last 20 years, thousands of times. And hundreds of times, I would say, in the future, you will be taxed by the mile. They're going to keep the old gas tax as well. They will track everywhere you go. They're already putting boxes in that track your history. Soon it'll be a cell phone-based system that tracks everything. That's now in place. And the host would say that'll never happen in America, even though the boxes were being put in. All cars made globally for the last 6 years have boxes in them that track everywhere you go and what you do and dial in via cell phone to central networks. How do you think your GPS in a new car tells you where there's traffic and tells you where there's bad weather and everything else? Because it's tied in via a cell connection to a central database hub. And everything you do is tracked. And again, it's being done to totally enslave you. But remember the denial. They'll never tax you by the mile. TxDOT is rolling out Google cars meant to replace humans. They'll just keep raising the insurance rates on humans until we can't drive, unless you're a billionaire. That's the admitted stated plan. You have to understand, most of this broadcast is their stated objective. And let me tell you, they get their objectives done. They are 10 to 15 years behind, depending on the program, but they're catching up. And if we roll over during this process, we're done. But their propaganda to an awake person seems very juvenile, very mindless, like you're talking to a lobotomized, chimpanzee or something. But you have to understand, they're communicating with the public that doesn't know what Independence Day is. I predict that if you did a national poll, well, they've done them where college graduates can't list any founding fathers and don't know just anything, that probably half the public doesn't know what Independence Day is. And that's what we found in California and Texas at universities, particularly. You find the stupidest people you've ever seen in your life. And that's because they're just going there to be milked for jobs that don't exist. So mom and dad can feel like they did a really great job and were great parents. Here it is. Oregon launches program to tax drivers by the mile. First it was, we'll let you opt into it. But now, no, we're going to just make you do it. David Hastings is a rare American. See how they always pitch it like it's really cool. It's really cool. This lady got her national ID card from the state. You got to have it to fly. It's really fun. Oh, it's really cool. This guy's a rare American. He was part of the, you know, David Hastings is a rare American. This longtime hybrid car owner from Oregon wants to pay higher taxes for roads and bridges and says the current 30 cents per gallon state tax barely affects him. I've been freeloading. I mean, listen, this whole thing's written as a psyop. Bet this guy's a PR hack. I've been freeloading on highways for 20 years, driving electric cars or hybrid cars, getting at least 40 miles to the gallon. So I haven't been paying my share. And it goes into how he's opted in to be part of it in a U.S. program. And it will be mandatory within 3-4 years. Bet your bottom dollar unless you say no. Then they're going to take your cars completely away from you. Let me just reset here on this final transmission before the 4th of July, 2015. It really hit me this morning, a rush of thoughts, a floodgate, like a dam breaking of understanding. And so much of it was thoughts that I've already had so many times, but the way they tied together, it was very clarion, very crystal. But you look at elephants or killer whales or things like that, top of the food chain, and you don't see a lot of things attacking them or trying to kill them, other than men, the super predator. And we're not the dominant species on this planet because we're physically the strongest or the biggest or the fastest. It's because we were smart and we could work as teams. And we had the will to build and design tools that grew into technologies. And now man faces in 2015, humankind, our greatest challenge. Will we be conquered by a subgroup, a legion of doom, a guild of evil, a mafia of death, a cult of destruction? Will we allow miscreant groups in our own species who cheat the human system to manipulate their fellow humans in a completely dishonorable way so that they can control and govern the future? Now, why don't other animals mess with killer whales? Why do sharks run from them? Why will a 25-foot great white run from a 30-foot killer whale? Run. Because they know where there's one, there's more. And they work together. They're mammals. And their jaws are bigger and they're stronger. And a great white doesn't enjoy something when it's eating it. Killer whale does. When we come back, I'm going to tie it all together. A key to defeating the globalist. All this and more on this Friday worldwide live July 3rd transmission. If you study criminology, Alex Jones here back live, and you understand megalomania and history, this is following a blueprint. And the establishment has a plan, but they are, with their criminal minds, mentally ill, basically, and on power trips. They crave total control over every nation, every individual, every thought you have. And that they would arrogantly fund radical Islamists, jihadis, out of Saudi Arabia with Western money and then change their name to try to confuse the public and now have all these terror alerts. And people, in my view, are confused. I'm going to talk about this. They seem to think because so much of Al-Qaeda was staged and governments and intelligence agencies and private corporations have been caught basically carrying out attacks and blaming it on patsies and funding criminal groups to carry out attacks. There's a whole grab bag of different types of synthetic terror. But this new ISIS threat is real in that they will probably, they've now done it in France and other areas, attack Western targets, and they've got recruiting arms all over the world. They've been allowed to mushroom. They've been allowed to breed, like leaving the window open so mosquitoes can fly in the middle of the summer. So, no, the government isn't the mosquito biting you, but they left the window open intentionally and left big pots of water out in the last few months under the trees so mosquitoes would breed. So the government is responsible for this. They're behind it, and they've done it nakedly where they can be caught because they know half the public doesn't even know what July 4th is. We've done a new video in Austin, Texas, at the University of Texas. And when people were from Saudi Arabia, speaking of Saudi Arabia, or from Mexico, or from Europe, they knew what 4th of July was and what Independence Day was. That's world famous. But here in the Republic, they don't know. I will guarantee you they know about Caitlyn Jenner. I will guarantee you they know that brown bags are racist. Video, Americans know nothing about the 4th of July. Are college students aware of Independence Day significance? Infowars.com. And I've had that video added to the bottom of the article and video that's on drudgereport.com. Citizens don't know what country we seceded from. And you know, you should go back to your town in Iowa or in New York or Florida or wherever. And I mean, I guarantee you, you talk to people above 40 or 50, they know all about it. Even if they're ignorant of other issues, you talk to young people. I mean, when I was a kid, I knew all about 1776. I thought it was really cool. And even though they didn't have movies about it and they don't promote it in the culture, so it dies. My family told me all about it and I read books about it. And I went and, you know, to D.C. and witnessed it for myself and saw the Constitution and the Bill of Rights and all the rest of it because my parents cared. And they gave me role models and heroes that mattered. Nowadays, we're given LeBron James. Nowadays, we're given Roger Staubach. And nothing against Roger Staubach or LeBron James, but I mean, I'm sorry. They just aren't that big a deal. I mean, my grandfather was like best friends basically with, you know, Tom Landry and was his roommate at UT and played football with him. And that's the first coach of the Dallas Cowboys, most famous coach, hands down, except for maybe Vince Lombardi. I don't sit there and get butterflies over the, you know, I've told people that are sports fans, they're like, really? Oh, that's amazing. I mean, just any connection. You know, there's NFL players that live in Austin, quite a few of them. Nothing against them. But, I mean, people will see them downtown. Like, oh, my gosh, that's such and such. I mean, who cares about a bunch of egomaniacs all calling themselves Lord this, God that, King this? I mean, I'm going to throw up. I mean, when I see LeBron James in King outfits with scepters, I think of African dictators doing the same thing we talked about last week. Or I think about Kim Jong-un. Or I think about that baboon woman over in England, the Queen of England. I mean, she's literally an old, ugly chimpanzee with a stupid crown on her head with a scepter. You stupid welfare witch! Tax-exempt, owns giant oil companies worth tens of trillions, has hundreds of giant palaces. I'm going to throw up. And then she goes out and gives speeches about austerity, and they cut the gas allotment from 85-year-olds in England so they freeze to death while they spend hundreds of millions of pounds a year heating her castles. So Kim Jong-un, the Queen of England, LeBron James, I mean, anybody that wants to wear a tiara, I just spit on you. That's all I got to say. And, you know, you look at the tabloids, you watch the news, you would think that we still have a sovereign monarch. They've trained 3-4 generations of American women to have teacups in their homes like that's classy of the royal family. I think I might get a royal bowl, use it as a bedpan. I mean, I desecrate royalty any chance I can. You know, when I'm around the office, I got to go to the bathroom. I'm not normally crude, but I go, guys, I got to go take a Queen Elizabeth. She is the second. People finally got it, though. They're like, oh, I get it. I go, yes. because these are the enemies. We need to create that culture of recognizing them. They know that. You have this abhorrence, the 21st century, of royalty crawling around, tax-exempt, getting tax money. Their wealth is a state secret, whether it's here or in the Netherlands. And you go out and you show Democrats, they've done this, we're doing it next week. You go and you show at the university four or five palace-sized houses, $40 million, $13 million, you name it. And you say, is this Donald Trump's? Everybody thinks he's the richest guy. The guy's literally nothing. Kind of just a front man for some consortiums on the East Coast. I'll leave it at that. Oh, yeah, Trump's piece of work, folks. And they go in there. It's just mind-blowing. I don't even know what to say anymore. And you show them a cardboard poster board with four mansions on it, and you say, is this Donald Trump's or Hillary Clinton's? And then when they understand that it's Hillary Clinton's, they get mad and upset with her. These are dangerous people. You should be mad at her. In fact, can you guys cue that up? I think it's like students upset at Hillary's mansions. It was like two or three days ago I meant to play it. I think I sent it to Nico. There it is. Young Americans shocked to learn of Hillary's multiple mansions. And see, they don't care if you invent something that saves lives or you write a best-selling book or whatever and you're rich. They don't like you because of it. They like Hillary because they think she's going to confiscate wealth and give it to them. And then when they realize that she has all these big mansions, hundreds of millions of dollars worth, they get upset and start hating her and say, well, now I'm not going to vote for her. And they think Donald Trump is the richest guy in the world. And they think that free market is what we have here when we now have a fascist system that uses socialism to engineer and control them. Now, I said I'd get to my whole parallel or allegory with the killer whales and the elephants versus other animals to try to explain things, and I'll do that in a moment. But first, let me just read to you some of the headlines here in the stack we'll be getting to in the next hour and your phone calls. Then we're going to have Peter Schiff back on, economist, multi-billion fund manager, to give us the latest on the situation in Greece. Greek banks down to $500 million in cash, €500 million in cash reserves as economy crashes. And again, as they prepare to default, they use the crashing economy for the globalists to come in and buy it up. The daily allowance of cash for many ATM machines has already dropped from €60 to €50, purportedly because 20 notes are running out. And they always titrate things in the reverse. They always slowly dull it down. When they end up taking your private pension funds, your 401ks, and they nationalize the stock down the road, they do this everywhere. It's an exact playbook. They will take pieces of it at first, and you'll be able to get out $100 a day, and then $70 a day, and then $60 a day, and then $40 a day, and then $20 a day, and then $10 a day, and then $1 a day. And you'll always be able to get your dollar. You'll be treated like a criminal when you go up and ask for it. But and what's this dollar for? Because we're land of the free, home of the brave, that doesn't know what 1776 is or independence. Hell, don't even know who your daddy is, even if your daddy comes home every night. But you know all about your imaginary friends on TV. What do you call it when you're a kid and you have an imaginary friend? You call it being a kid. What do you call it when you're an adult? You call it being insane. But see, we have imaginary friends on TV, and people think they're more real than the real world. And the brain sees it as an imaginary friend. It's the same thing. That's what fiction is. Well, see, this isn't fiction right here. I'm not your imaginary friend, okay? I'm in here watching this country get overrun, and I'm in danger even being here, okay? I mean, this is not some boss hog takeover just to loot stuff and then pump up the economy and skim it. They want to break it because they want to break you and your family. They want to dominate you. You always hear the story of robbers coming in and they'll tie up the family and rob the house for 4 or 5 hours and then go, you know what? Let's rape the wife and the kids. And you know what? Let's go ahead and shoot dad in the head. Oh, we killed him. Now we got to kill the wife and the kids. And people always say, why'd they do that? Why not just leave with the jewelry and the money? Why would they want to have murder investigations? Say, well, what? Because they like to kill people. That's why. Get it through your head. They want to hurt you and your family. That's why they put fluoride and over 200 other chemicals on average in your water. Our DNA is now unraveling. The IQ has dropped 14 points in the last 30 years. We're in red level crisis. They are murdering everyone and laughing and writing books about it. Criminals love to brag, don't they? Because they're so invincible. They're so powerful. Hillary likes to get up and say, we funded ISIS. We funded Al-Qaeda to cover her butt, to hide it in plain view like it has no power. Yeah, I slept with your wife, Bob. It's no big deal. Let's go get a drink. That's a better way to tell Bob when you know it's about to come out you've been sleeping with his wife than letting him find out and build up anger. Bob, I slept with your wife. It's not that big a deal. Now that it's out, I know you're embarrassed. It's okay. It's okay. Let me get you a beer. And that's us. Oh, guess what? We're going to tax you by the mile. Oh, guess what? We're going to make robots drive your cars. Incrementally, though, where they break when you should break and then gives you a message bossing you around. The total nanny state of a coward, broken, pathetic, dumb public that doesn't even know what country they're in. I mean, we pretty much have to look at the establishment's plan now to exterminate everybody because they've already done everybody down so bad that they are a bigger danger than the elite. You go, wait, you just endorsed them. No, I didn't. I'm going from it from a scientific perspective, pulling back logically and looking at what they've done. We're so wrecked that you'll never be able to rehabilitate half the population that will, with pleasure, put you in a forced labor camp to supply goodies for them. You understand, with ignorance comes evil. With ignorance comes the will to hurt others, not have empathy. Do you think any of these people that don't know what Independence Day is, do you think they care if you get hauled off to a forced labor camp? You never thought they'd have forced inoculations. You never thought they'd have forced taxation by the mile tracking you. You never thought. They have activated in the last 5 years giant internment camps all over the U.S., and the Army put out ads to hire corrections officers and former military to man them with the U.S. Army and how to process Social Security numbers and how to put political prisoners in areas and, quote, re-educate us. They are training in the U.S. military, the officer corps, to have Army colonels and generals over every U.S. city running everything and disappearing thousands per city to then be handed over to the leftist political corps to be tortured and beaten to death by giant sacks of cowardly trash. This is a victory of dishonor and weakness over everything that's good. This is a country hell-bent for bondage. Our country, financially, spiritually, and culturally, is going to be chopped up like the 55 million aborted babies. We're going to be judged. We're going to have national ID cards. You're going to go to church, and you're going to give money with a thumbprint. And the big, evil demon preacher, if you could see him, big black wings and a big red tail and big fangs and big horns, up there, Baphomet, with just naked whores all in front of him, blood and dead babies just spewing out, more demons up on that pulpit anywhere else in your major city. The center of Satanism is in these churches and just vomiting evil out, vomiting submission, vomiting death and evil. That's what's coming to America if we don't stop this. You notice suddenly just everything's starting to get crazy. They're announcing everything. We're going to teach your five-year-olds this and that. We're going to open the borders up. We're going to pay for the illegals everything. We're going to tax you by the mile. We're going to forcibly inoculate you. We're going to grab money out of your accounts and give it to private banks whenever they want it. We're going to arrest Amish. We're going to shut down lemonade stands. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. You understand, I could play you newscasts where they admit they put over 200 chemicals in the water. It's not just fluoride, lead, mercury, arsenic. And that's not to mention all the runoff of the glyphosate giving you cancer. They're murdering everyone. We'll devalue human life. And think that that dishonor gets us ahead. We'll cheat. And hope nobody else notices. That's the equivalent of peeing in the pool. Then everyone starts doing it, and well, now the pool's no good. But the globalists aren't peeing in the pool. They are defecating in the pool. And no, it's not Baby Ruth. To quote Caddyshack, at the 8 after break, I'm going to get into my allegory because it's so important and tie it all together. But it comes down to this. We have freedom and private property because we would fight to the death for it. And compared to other systems and empires, that's what we become. We were more moral as an empire because the elites were very smart and virtuous to a certain extent and were really so confident that they wanted to empower humanity. And that's what 1776 was all about. George Washington relished not becoming king, and the royalty of the world just sat there with their mouths open, and King George III wrote a public letter and said, George Washington is the greatest man alive in the world. Everyone else would have declared themselves a king, and there would have been a royal lineage. George Washington wanted to go back to his farm, back to his dogs. Because he was a lot like a dog. Smart, loving, loyal, strong. A real man. And that's why they demonize him. They hate honorable people. But I'll tell you this, George Washington was a predator at the same time. He was a killer. And that's what separates free people from slaves. Is that we will fight. We will not bow. We have the instinct to not be slaves. It's in us. We can't help it. And the sad thing I realize is, for most people, I understand why they're followers. They just don't have it. I had a lot of old-timers, a lot of smart people, a lot of military officers. Generals, colonels, three-star generals, special forces people. My whole life growing up and on the air, they'd say, Alex, you keep trying to get the general public itself to lead and to fight and to do this. You're either born with it or you don't have it. And more I realize that's the case. Well, here's the thing. A lot of you out there were born with a spark to want to be free and born to try to help others and born to be honorable. And if you don't take action, God hates you more, I can tell you, than the actual evil globalist, because they are fallen and are who they are and of their father, the devil. You and your family have been pointed at God, and you've turned away from your responsibilities and what your bloodline has done, and you are a shame, and you are absolutely pathetic. Where are the other men? Where are the leaders? Where are the people to resist this? I got a funder operation, so I'm going to put this plug in right now. InfoWarsLife.com. I want to thank you all for supporting us. I'm not rebuking our general audience. I'm talking to the world. Our general audience is the salt of the earth. I'm talking about all these famous people and Hollywood folks and billionaires and folks that tell me, oh, you're doing such a great job. Thanks for doing it. I'm glad somebody's doing it. You need to do it. Not just me. I want to beat these people. I don't want to be a slave. I don't want evil to triumph. And it will, because good men are doing nothing. I mean to you. What's the Declaration of Independence stand for? I'm going to open the phones up and ask that question. And our listeners will be like, well, we know exactly what it stands for. Independence from Britain. The idea of more human liberty. Getting out from under monarchy. I know, but we need to obviously discuss it and discuss how do we get the word out to others. That this is what's really cool. This is reason you've had all this prosperity. And now it's been stolen, and they're going to scapegoat the free market and everything good on the back of what they've engineered. There's so much news I'm going to get to, but I want to really break down the difference between a free people and what makes a people free and independent and what makes a slave. What are the attributes of slaves? What are the attributes of free people? Are there any attributes to slaves? How do slaves get into the position of being a slave? We're going to look at that in depth in the next segment. And then you knew this was coming. I mean, it was the trial lawyers that were the biggest lobbies for it that actually started it about 10 years ago, accelerating the push when people thought it would never happen. Of course, we knew it would. It's part of a larger agenda. But it was the trial lawyers that wanted to get gay marriage in so they could basically take all the confused, ignorant people that don't understand that fighting a divorce basically screws both sides and suck off of them. I mean, a corrupt divorce lawyer's favorite friend is the ignorant spouse that doesn't make the money and that's been at home playing tennis for 20 years and hanging out at the country club, and then she decides she's going to leave her husband. That's generally the story. And the lawyers run the case until all the money's gone. And then magically, everything comes to an agreement. The lawyers say, stop doing what you're doing to the woman, generally, as soon as all the money's gone. I mean, they might leave you the house so you can sell that and split that. They're nice. They might leave you 5%, 10% of whatever you had. And here it is out of CBS News. Country's first gay divorce firm opens in Philadelphia. That's like Rand Paul said. I mean, what do you want the government involved in your life? They shouldn't be involved in regular marriage. And by the way, it is regular marriage. It's the institution of where it came from. Men and women, you know, mammals, male and female having sex and producing offspring. So the existence of saying that's normal biology isn't meant to hurt your feelings. And I'm not apologizing. I'm showing you how you've been induced into mental illness, thinking people are stepping on your toes. And it's not even the gays so much, but all the political correct fellow travelers. There's a video Watson did on Infowars.com. His latest dealing with the University of Wisconsin, where they're saying complimenting a minority is racist. Basically, now there's another university professor coming out saying premenstrual cramps are caused by men. I'm not joking. That's right. And if a rain cloud comes over and rains on you, it's because of the men. You cannot make this up. And if you say we're a colorblind society, that's now racism, you know, Martin Luther King quote. Because no. We will identify on race and color and all of this to fight with each other. And now, the Salt Lake City Tribune saying you can't have marriage equality without polygamy. That's right. And then it's going to be you should be able to marry your toaster. Or you should be able to self-identify as a dog. Or you should be able to marry 8 people. I mean, this is what is happening. While we go into a debt spiral of total collapse, we have all these mental midgets, like this professor, running around saying men make her have bad menstrual cramps. That, I mean, men just magically have a wand. I mean, it's just idiots. Here are some of the headlines. U.S. citizen gets 8 years in prison for driving away from an internal checkpoint. But illegal aliens are allowed to have their babies for free and get everything paid for. And the Obama administration had been lying, saying that they hadn't stopped deportations. That was a conspiracy theory. Now that they're just letting the hammer drop and just doing whatever they want openly, Washington Post, Obama administration scales back deportations in policy shift. So they're now admitting they're just not going to deport people, including felons. They're going to release 36,000 of them, I guess, in the next few months, like they did in the last year. They're going to expand that, but then have hissy fits over 2 missing guys out of a penitentiary and then kill one of them and wound the other and have huge press conferences and celebrations. When all over the country, they just release rapists, arsonists, murderers, you name it. It's just craziness because it's part of their larger agenda. Now, I'm going to talk more about this. I already mentioned it, but country's first gay divorce firm opens in Philadelphia. That's a big part of why the trial lawyers have been lobbying so hard for that. That's a chunk of cash they haven't been able to get, a very large chunk. Nathan Collier, Montana man inspired by same-sex marriage ruling, requests right to wed two wives. And there's an article out of the Salt Lake paper calling for the same thing, saying Mormons should be able to go back to that practice. Because in their, you know, their argument is, you know, Abraham had, I don't know, however many wives or whatever. So I guess that's where that's going. I personally don't. It sounds like a nightmare to me. But I think obviously you could have a bigger biblical argument for that than you could for two men together. But hey, anything goes. Let people marry their dog or their horse. I mean, Caligula did marry his horse and make it the leader of the Roman Senate. And so maybe Obama should marry a horse, or maybe maybe Michelle should marry a donkey. Name Democrat. I mean, anything goes. Maybe Barbara Bush can marry a gorilla. I mean, George W. Bush did look like a chimpanzee, didn't he? Yeah. I don't know. My sister went to the same private school as his daughters. I didn't get to go to the fancy private school, but my sister did. And so I was at a few barbecues that Bush was at before he was governor and then when he was governor. And I watched speeches he gave and followed him because he was very articulate, smart, funny guy. His hair went from being brown to gray when he got elected. And then like they cattle prodded him or something. I mean, that wasn't the same person that was in Austin, Texas, I can tell you, but I'm digressing. That's coming up. Greek banks down to 500 million euros and maybe out by the end of the weekend. Folks are only allowed to get 20 euros out a day of their bank accounts. I mean, in Greece, that won't even buy you dinner. Very expensive island with low wages. And, of course, the economy is now in free fall because the bankers are freezing any of the wire transfers of people that set up vacations, rented boats, got hotels, booked tours. That's just being diverted to where the federal government and others have ordered them to. So and there's no law. They just do it. That'll teach Greece. Greek bank closures may deplete supermarket shelves, and that's actually already happened. That's in Reuters. And all of this is shades of what is coming to this country with the spoiled, arrogant population and then the hardworking population. There are two different types of Americans, really, when it boils down to it. Super hardcore Americana, working people of every race, color, and creed that bust their butts and are too prideful to get handouts. And then you've got everybody else. And a lot of folks were prideful and tried to work in the system, but they got harassed. They got written tickets. They got messed with so long. They got sick. They got hurt. And so they're like, fine, I'll just join with it and wait for it to collapse. But still, the majority of the other folks are just arrogant and hateful. And they look at somebody that's got a nice car and a nice house. They don't think, hey, that person provides jobs for their employees. They don't think, hey, that person buys goods and services. No, misery loves company. They want you to live in a shack with liquor stores, with poor people buying lottery tickets, and your daughter's out on the street corner getting in cars and having sex in the back seat for $20. That's the world that the trendies and the liberals want to build. And they're into stuff that's ugly and stuff that's malformed. I mean, you can see the styles that are pushed by the system. And the CIA declassified that last year. They've been pushing ugliness and dirtiness and mutilating your body. It's biblical. You go, well, I don't believe that. Well, believe history. The globalists are obsessed with the occult. They are the super predators. And when I tell you this story right now, something that's absolutely key to everything, I didn't get this from American Sniper. I heard this sheepdog speech so many times growing up from football coaches, from my dad, from my grandfathers, just from everybody. Never saw it on television, never read about it in the book. It's big in the military. I don't care if you're in Michigan or you're in California. You run into a bunch of conservative veterans, they'll talk about sheepdogs all day. And it's because it's absolutely key to everything. A 25-foot great white shark will run from a 30-foot killer whale or even a 15-foot juvenile. Now, why does it do that? There's an image of a juvenile attacking a great white shark on screen. That is a juvenile killer whale attacking it. Why will great whites even run from dolphins that are a third their size? Because they know that where there's one, there's more. And because they know that they're smarter and they're faster. They know that they want to get as far away from them as fast as they can. Now, why did we have private property and so much wealth and such low regulations in America that made us the place to move, the place to be, with the most patents, the most inventions, the most wars won? Historians all over the world saying we were exceptional, we were the best. I mean, that was admitted 100 years ago. Hands down, no debating it. Now we are the worst. We are the worst in the world. Per capita on every benchmark. IQ, test scores, everything. And I'll tell you why. What is a killer whale? It's a giant wolf. But you know, they don't attack each other. And that's the difference. They love each other. They're sheepdogs. And when the wolf tries to come around, the shark, they attack. And they're fearless because they're programmed, they're innate, their very being is they're not cowards. And you know what? They don't act tough. They don't go around starting fights for no reason. They just are cool. Now, they're not cool when they're eating a baby whale. But the point is that America was like a nation of killer whales. We had our problems, but we were the best. Now we are a nation of stupid, weak, pathetic, castrated men, dumbed down, arrogant women, haughty, reveling in our stupidity, reveling in our loss of freedom, and we are the mark. We're no longer the aquatic mammals. The killer whales. We now are, you've heard my analogy of this before, the right whale. Slow, stupid, basically roll over and let you put a harpoon in them. Doesn't even know that a whaling boat's pulling up to kill you. Sperm whales see a whaling boat, boom, they go down. Not right whales. Slow, stupid, begging for it. They were almost extincted. But, you know, I shouldn't call us a right whale because right whales are super sweet. They want to play with people. They're just very actually godly creatures. So I guess I shouldn't compare us to the right whale. But the globalists see us as that. We're more like petulant, demonic monkeys or something that won't even stand up for each other. And that's why we're being enslaved, because we're dishonorable, cowardly chumps that dehumanized babies, and now we're dehumanizing old people, now we're going to dehumanize handicapped folks, and I use that politically incorrect word on purpose. It's okay to kill handicaps, just don't call them handicaps, as if handicap is a bad word. See, it started with stuff like that to get you to agree to use the language that the establishment said. Well, I'll use any language I want. I'll say fireman if I want. I'll say handicap if I want. And not because they're even the best word to use, but because you told me not to, scumbag. So, a wolf wants to go out and rip sheep's guts out, and he'll have fun, even though it's already eaten, and kill 6 or 7 sheep. A sheepdog, one-on-one, can take on the biggest wolf because it's trained and bred to kill wolves. It's sweet with your kids. It's sweet at home. It's sweet sleeping down at the end of your bed or in front of the fireplace. But when a wolf comes out, it goes on it, it chases it down, it pushes it down to the ground, and it rips its throat out. And it's got long hair, so the wolf can't bite it as easily. That's armor. We are no longer a nation of sheepdogs. We are a nation of legless gerbils, laid out like a buffet, rolling around for wolves to come eat us. We've had our eyes gouged out. We've had our ears gouged out. We don't even know what's eating us. We just know it hurts. And so when we start acting like men again, when we stop bowing down to corruption again, when we stop submitting to all this again, when we start raising our children to understand they're under attack, they'll start listening to us again. When we become tribal again. See, they're worried about that, so they get us all fighting over tribal garbage that doesn't matter instead of a human tribe coming together against the global technocrats. That's the key. I'm not here running this country down. If you've got a friend or family member who's, you know, been drinking a bottle of vodka every day and their liver's failing, you know, you need to stand over their bed and scream at them and tell them to get their act together. And it's so sad to see where this country's been maneuvered to by successive approximation. Incrementally, we've been put into a trance state, and we've incrementally had almost all our freedoms removed, but the globalists weren't acting on it fully. We knew that when they got to the point of admitting it and accelerating it, we were in deep trouble. And they've now hit the gas, turned the nitrous oxide on, and they're racing to the finish line, dismantling everything. And they want you to believe resistance is futile. There's a national poll out in Rasmussen today that a vast majority of Americans say they're just not going to follow federal edicts. They're going to stop complying, and that they want states to just nullify everything. And the feds could try to start a fight with a state, militarily occupy it, probably try to claim it's over racism again, just like the Civil War. Notice they're trying to repeat that, to have the feds have the moral authority to come into the states while they finance race war. So they need to have this civil war, but have it be quick to establish the idea that, no, the federal government is self-run by offshore collaborators. Is taking over. I mean, this is really going on. This is the battle plan. Wars, depression, all of it, they're planning it to bring in the planetary government. The popes come out and call for world government. All these other world leaders, world government, world carbon tax, tax you by the mile, track everything you do. Your kids don't belong to you. It's here. And so I'm not fear-mongering. A lot of folks hear the show and they go, well, my gosh, you make me want to slip my wrist. I'm depressed. Don't be depressed. We're here raising the alarm. We've gotten in this position because people will never wake up. They're in the best position to wake up out of their trance in a really angry mood they've ever been in. Because let me tell you, the globalists are scared because they know things can turn on a dime in the blink of an eye, in the snap of your fingers. They know and are running to armored redoubts outside of the countries they're about to loot. They're leaving Israel, they're leaving the United States, they're leaving France. And it's not just over taxation, it's over prosecution. They know there's a good chance we're going to take things back. And they got a big confidence game that they're invincible. And they've got the paid devil churches with their World Council of Churches run by the Rockefellers teaching it's the end of the world next week, praise God, don't go out and fight corruption. Just stay in here at the country club and let your kids play the Kinect box and retina scan and digitally thumbprint to give your donations, and the government loves you, and when the Antichrist arrives, they're going to say it's Jesus. I mean, you know that, right? Brother Johnson's been taken away because he was engaged in hate against our Christ, and no one's allowed to promote hate. We saw how the terrorist attacked the Christ compound. The leader, you can just see it. It's global government, even if the Bible isn't true, they're producing it and using it as a playbook. 10 global regions, 3 mega regions, 10 world leaders, 1 leader who'll become the leader. I mean, you know the world government, there's going to be 1 leader, right? With all these corporate men, all the kings of the earth, giving their power to the beast, submitting, Because he'll give them power? You're not going to hear this. If your church isn't telling you to go out and fight for children's lives, at least educate people about abortion, if they're not telling you to fight world government, if they're not warning you about fluoride, if they're not warning you about tyranny and just saying, yes, things are getting scary, it means the coming of the Lord is soon, just get right with God. Do you think God, that built you and made you in his image for this test on this planet, is going to have anything to do with you if you fail this boot camp? That's how the universe works. You think you're going to lay down while people get attacked and torn apart? And the infinitely awesome God that created this fantastic reality for us to be tested is going to sit there and going to let you enter into that next level? That next dimension? Do you think you're going to be allowed into that when you're a servile, backstabbing piece of garbage? CJ made a great point earlier. We're chickens, not legless gerbils. So chicken will only attack you when your back's turned. It's easily startled. Blah, 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 you know, running around. It's just a nation of stampeding cowards. So on July 4th, pull up! Break your trance! Wake up! The New World Order's poison! What's the 4th of July mean to you? What do you think these idiots not knowing what it is? 800-259-9231. 800-259-9231.
We're on the march.
And I'm sorry if I'm so angry today. It's just, we're being completely overrun by the globalists. I mean, I said 8 years. I misread the headline. Man gets 8 months in federal prison for driving away from internal checkpoint, but the illegals are exempt from it. And we've got Border Patrol 75 miles into Texas admitting to our cameraman, well, why do you want to ask me? It doesn't matter anymore. And the Border Patrol goes, yeah, you're right. It doesn't. And Obama has officially announced what we already knew. He's halting basically all deportations, but like 1% where it's murderers that are being extradited. If the country requests it. They're releasing aggravated felons everywhere. But there's no pomp and circumstance to get the chickens all stirred up. You know, when the establishment media says get stirred up, people get stirred up. People say they don't trust the media in polls. Mainstream media's numbers are way down. But still, the mainstream media can all line up together and rope-a-dope one more time. Oregon State issues a gag order against opposing gay marriage. So you can't say you're against gay marriage, and you can walk on American flags and burn them, though. That's in the news today. We're going to be covering that. Now, I want to talk to the listeners about what does July 4th mean to you, Independence Day, and what do you think of the public in California and in Texas? And yes, we go to liberal areas to show you these are not liberal. Liberal means well-learned and that you are for freedom. And they are the most ignorant people, black, white, Hispanic, it doesn't matter, that the world has ever seen. Who doesn't know what July 4th is? I mean, that's hard to believe. And 8 out of 10 in California, 6 out of 10 in Austin, Texas, we're not editing. I mean, we're just cutting out the spaces. We're showing you everybody we talk to. Talk to, was it 10 or more people, and two of them knew exactly what Independence Day was. Two more kind of did, and six had no idea. They thought it was in 1965. They thought it was, you know, secession from Mexico or Spain. One of the ones I hear a lot is, and it's on the tape, is the South. That's when we got independence from the South. Didn't you know that? And so you sit there watching Obama say 2 + 2 = 5, and you're like, that's crazy. And raising the debt limit doesn't raise the debt. And you go, it doesn't make sense. It's so discrediting. He's talking to people that are delusional and believe whatever they see on television and who've bought into Obama so he could tell them stick their hand in a meat grinder or jump off a cliff, and they do it. They're in a trance. So I get angry at them. I get mad at them. I want to slap them. I'm going to be honest. And I love how they always got sunglasses and trendy clothes. Like, oh, yeah, what's it? I'm so funny. I'm so cool. It's all they've got is just posing. It's like these guys that'll strut around with their muscle shirts and, hey, watch where you're going for no reason. And the minute you say, man, just make a swing, I'm going to bash your brains out, they back off real quick. Because they can tell you're ready. I'm not looking for trouble, man, but I'm sick of all these fake people. I'm tired of it. I'm tired of people writing checks they can't cash. I'm tired of being a cowardly nation. But, you know, it's what you expect. You could have the wealthiest, smartest, greatest parents, hardest working people, whatever. Or the strongest. But if you don't ever work out and lift weights and exercise, you're going to be a weak, fat blob that dies of a heart attack or diabetes. And it's the same thing politically. We are just a bunch of spoiled, rotten, pathetic, unthankful garbage, and we need to repent. And hey, if you don't believe in God, that's your issue. But, I mean, it is good to get on your knees and repent for all the bad things you've done. I want to do it right now. I have been a slob. I have not been as focused. I have not been as good a father as I could have been. I have not been with my children as much as I should have been. And I'm a worldly person, and I'm a lustful person, and I'm a hateful person. But my heart loves God, and I'm also a good, virtuous, loving person. But I need to admit the bad in me and mentally get to where I don't like it so I don't accept it. Because when I catch myself being bad, eating like a pig, drinking too much, saying hateful things about people, thinking hateful things, thinking of dirty tricks, which I never pull, but I could, I don't do it, and I'm ashamed that I would even have those thoughts. Now, you take someone who wants to be moral versus someone who doesn't care or doesn't even know what morals are. I mean, that's it. We don't have morals anymore. We have faux morals. Oh, you're a goddess. You're a creepy 60-something-year-old man who wants to dress up as a woman. Good, do it. And don't be on the power trip that I'm obsessed with it and I care and, you know, blah, blah, blah. No, it's weird to have that push as the number one thing in the country. It's just a signpost of a collapsing civilization. Imagine hearing about an alien species on a planet that has all this technology and could get off the planet, but they're obsessing over men wearing dresses. I mean, it just, you'd say, oh, yeah, no planet exists like that. It's just stupid. But they replace all of our basic freedoms and our basic honor and culture with just mindless new morals of, I did my recycling, but you don't care about GMO destroying the planet or nanotech or any of the real threats or nuclear war looming. You just moralize, I've got a hybrid and you don't. Oh my God, look at his truck. Look at that gas guzzler. I'm moral. You're not. I sent around a charity thing on Facebook. I didn't give any money, but I sent out the link. I feel so good about myself. I'm so moral. You're a poser. You're fake. Our problem is fake people. All right, I'm going to go to your phone calls. Chris, Kevin, Paul, Ronnie, James, and others. Can the disease of the mind be reversed? Or do we just organize as thinking, hardworking folks in a global alliance of renaissance and withdraw our support from the system and everything and come together, and then we'll have so much wealth and power not complying, they'll call us criminals, that the world will then convert to our ideas. Not by conquest, but by the velvet glove of imitation. I mean, that's really it. The laws are criminal. The laws now are inverted. I will not commit crimes in the face of God and against my own conscience, whatever it is. I will not sit here and just be dictated to by a bunch of cultural Marxists run by foreign bankers, richer than any emperor ever was, creating class warfare on the grassroots. And I will not feed on and play off of and cater to and truck with the zombies either. They are sad, pathetic victims. They have no, their souls basically been anesthetized. There's something there, but it's not active. And I pray their eyes be opened. I pray they come out of their slug states. But I realize they are just a vicious, dangerous mob. who will tear any good, virtuous person to bits just as they'll tear a baby apart. Think about a woman in a movie where the murderer's trying to get her. I was on the elliptical, and there was some woman's TV show on at the gym, two TVs down. I was watching it in the closed captioning, and some guy was beating up a woman who was pregnant. What a mean, horrible guy. Of course, he is horrible. But then that same woman, I bet you, you know, or women watching are like, but it's good to chop the baby up, though. That's okay, because it's professional and it's medical. Yeah, it's a medical thing. And then see, once they get you involved in it, you'll defend it for the rest of your life, never admitting you were conned and it was wrong. And saying, gee, I wish I would have known that. Not saying you're a bad person. All God wants you to do is admit you were conned and have empathy for the baby you chopped up. But no, you won't do that. And so you'll make excuses for the death panels for the troops, which they admit are operating. And then they admit more being put on the don't treat list. That was in the news last week. See, it just gets worse, and you just don't care. But you care about saying that we're all created equal and that we're colorblind. That's now racist, according to the University of Wisconsin. You're like, well, that's crazy. It's meant to be crazy. It's meant, if they tell you to stand on your head, you do it, or they'll call you a racist name. You're like, well, I don't care if they call me racist. In the future, they're going to turn your national ID card off, and then they're going to pick you up when you're homeless. They're going to have laws against the homeless, and then they're going to take you to a labor camp. And you know who's going to be there? Re-educators. And that's in the Army document. They use the word re-education camp. Hillary began to break the ice. She got this demonic look on her face, and she went, yeah, you know what we need for our men is a fun camp. We ought to start sending our men to a camp. And all these weird-looking women behind her were like, ugh. The same kind that'll start. If you go to an abortion event, they'll run up and go, Satan, I love you. Whether it's an old woman or a young woman, see me in a business suit or in a goth outfit, they'll just suddenly go, Satan, because that's what they are. Men to fun camps. Camps, power. They don't have any real power. They have no honor. They just see the gleam of evil and its power and the black uniforms and the stench of death camps. And they just go, oh, death camps, fine. I'll have power. The men will be sent to the re-education. I kill my children. I worship Satan. Because that spirit possesses them and animates them. That archetype, whatever you want to call it. I told you I'd seen it before, and they appeared when I had cameras at abortion clinic, and they appeared at UT spontaneously. They were just there in the crowd, and women just encircled the Christians and went, Satan, 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 oh, give us power, ah, Satan. And those women were probably never in a satanic black mass. They just know it. Their eyes were all just electric with enjoyment. Because they could feel the power of all those dead babies and that sacrifice. They were joining with Satan. And I told you, I've been out to abortuaries, and people always show up going, I love Satan. I want to kill people. I want to kill black people. And sure enough, they showed up going, I love Satan. I stink. I have hair under my arms, and I kill my children. Ah! That's all they've got. That's their accomplishment. Like one guy's, I go raise money in the community. I've killed 40-something children, and I love it. I want to kill them with pentagrams all over them. I'm liberal. Oh, God, I love Satan. Oh, Satan, I love you. I'm liberal. I'm the moral authority. I'm in an 80,000 black Jaguar. Oh, Satan, Satan. I mean, they're just calling out to their God. That's who they are. And it's their country now to turn upside down and run down and destroy. So, the 4th of July is a new declaration of independence against them and against everything they stand for and all the fake placeholder Republicans that are the loyal opposition that work for the system. You may have lost your soul. I haven't lost mine. Mine's getting stronger every day. My discernment is intensifying every day. The gifts of the Spirit are growing stronger every day. I don't even feel worthy in this body to be bringing you this information. It is humbling. And I can tell you something right now. All of you could activate your soul. All of you could get in touch with God. God's got the answers to beat these people. All right, I'm going to go to your phone calls. But Joe Biggs did a piece that's one of the best ever. We do these little news vignettes, but also patriotic ideas, just basic philosophy, culture. We have a culture. They don't have a culture. Their culture's death. Our culture's life, exploration, honor, kinship, family, love between men and women and children, strength and honor. What do they have? Just look at what they produce. Falling down, rotting cities in agony and pain. Joe Biggs put it together, and I agree with him. This is what July 4th, this is what Independence Day is all about.
Do you know what it means to be an American? It's more than a flag. It's more than knowing the Star Spangled Banner. It's knowing the Constitution. It's understanding those rights and fighting for them. Our country's falling apart because people have forgotten to fight, to stand up in the face of tyranny and do the right thing. It's putting your life on the line to protect your country from enemies both foreign and domestic. The Bill of Rights is what the people are entitled to against every government, and no government should refuse or on inference. So the Tree of Liberty must be refreshed from time to time with the blood of patriots and tyrants. I'm Joe Biggs with Infowars.com, and I believe our flag is more than cloth and ink. It is a symbol that stands for liberty and freedom. It is the history of our nation, and it's marked by the blood of those who died defending it. So join me in this info war. Turn off your TV, put your Cheetos down, get off your butt, and join the resistance.
Keyword resistance. We are occupied. We are captured. And I don't say that to lower morale. I say it that when the people know that and they know we're being run by foreign banks, it's only a matter of time. But the globalists are smart. They know the euro will collapse. They know the American Union will collapse. They know the Asian Union will collapse. They're designed, after they suck us dry, to collapse into the new fraud. I'm going to go to a call. We're going to come back and take more calls. Thanks for holding. Kevin in Florida, what does July 4th mean to you?
Thank you for taking my call, Alex.
Welcome.
I mean, July 4th, I mean, for my family means a lot. My grandpa was a Korean War POW. So, I mean, it means a lot. We used to always celebrate barbecues and stuff. But I got to piggyback on what you've been saying. I totally agree with what you said about, you know, I saw your guys' vignette about what is July 4th going around all these colleges. And honestly, I'm not really surprised because the way what they teach in school is so much of a joke now. They don't teach what really needs to be taught.
I'm glad you raised that. No. It's all about the Klan. I don't care. U.S. history, local, whatever. It's just Klan. White people are racist. Obama loves you. Michelle Obama says eat this food. They don't teach anything but how to obsess over petty garbage.
I mean, I can't agree more. I mean, they won't talk about, you know, anything that has to do with the fabric or the foundation of what this country was founded on or what it stands
for.
No,
all they do is run it down now. First, they didn't teach it, so you won't know what it is. Now they lie about it and twist it to then bring it down. I'm telling you, the American flag's next.
I mean, first the Confederate flag, then the American flag, like you said about the flag burning, which is totally and utterly disgusting. But going back to what I was saying earlier, they won't talk about anything about having to do with America, but those sensationalized, ridiculous stuff like Bruce Jenner's publicity stunt to become a woman and rap music that sensationalizes beating women and, you know.
Oh, listen, I mean, they have top MTV awards and stuff where there's burning police cars and stuff up on the stage. I mean, the establishment wants to get this thing started. They want a revolution between the people against each other, not against them. God bless you. We're going to go to break, and we're going to come back with more of your phone calls. Stay with us, ladies and gentlemen.
We celebrate the 4th of July as a reminder of earning our independence from a tyrannical and oppressive government. Just a reminder to the Obama administration, there's plenty of room on the calendar for another holiday.
And to be absolutely clear there, we mean no harm against the dictator-in-chief. He's a puppet. That would turn him into a martyr. We're just saying tyranny will fall. We're going to be watching the situation in Greece very closely with the vote Saturday. That's very important, whether they'll stay in the EU or not, basically. I'll be live this Sunday, despite the holiday weekend. I was just trying to eat during a three-minute break. It didn't work too well. But getting back to your calls here in a moment, the reason I had the Freudian slip, I was about to say Hollywood, is I was just thinking during the break, Hollywood is so disconnected from reality, so corrupt, that when they push all of these crazy agendas on the public, there's going to be a bigger backlash than they think. And it's already happened. Hollywood loses billions of dollars every year because more and more people will not support anything they're putting out across the board because of the incredible brainwashing that's contained in it. And you're just going to see a bigger exodus out of the system. That's why there's an article out today, Oregon State issues gag order against opposing gay marriage. In a sign of overt fascism and religious persecution to come in the wake of the left's emboldened by the Supreme Court recent gay marriage ruling, a judge in Oregon has issued a gag order denying two Christian bakery owners from speaking out against same-sex marriage. That's right. They put a gag order on them saying you have no free speech. I mean, this is amazing. And now there's calls. Well, it's happened. The court ruled to take down the Ten Commandments. See, they're making their move right now. And it's all over the world this is happening. I'm not really plugging a lot today. I should be. I'm going to go back to Chris and others here in just a moment. I'm not going to belabor the fact that in the month of July, we have free shipping on everything. In the month of July, we also have 10% off on all T-shirts. And we have 25% off the Molon Labe, three different design belt buckles. One of them did just sell out, so it gets us two designs that are left. So you get free shipping on top of specials like that. And there are too many specials out of the 500-plus products on the website to go over all of them, but there are more than 50 specials going at InfoWarsStore.com. That is the blanket umbrella site for InfoWarsLife.com and MadeIn1776.com. And when you buy high-quality products from us, you get quality products at very competitive prices, and you support the very tip of the spear of real teleprompter-free radio and TV. So thank you so much. Okay, let's go to Chris in North Carolina. Thanks for calling. What is your view on the 4th of July? Go ahead.
Yes, I'm a patron, by the way, and I'm a CTM or a Navy veteran.
Well, God bless you, sir.
Well, as a CTM, I had a top secret clearance, and I want to talk about NSA, not spying, but a program in the NSA called Tempest.
Okay, go ahead, sir.
All right. So, I don't know, you could type in NSA Tempest, and you can look it up. And basically, if you read down through the jargon, it says they sell out to the industry. But yet, my supervisor told me never to talk about it, yet he didn't say it was classified, but I'm sure it was, but he said he didn't say it was, so I can give it away. It's basically like shielding computers with copper. And I know this is too detailed for any...
No, stay there. I'm gonna hold you over. For those that don't know, they've caught the big chip manufacturers building into them capacitors that can be charged from a distance using basically cell phone radiation to then download the info off your computer and transmit it. And so they harden the computers, not just not plugging them into walls, but jacketing them in copper so that that can't happen. I think that's what you're getting at. Anna is our guest. Caller. Then we're going to talk to Paul, Ronnie, James, Mike, and others, and I'm just going to keep our guests 30 minutes, so I'm going to go back to your calls after Peter Schiff leaves us. We're going to be breaking down the situation in Greece. But look at this article. X-Keyscore, NSA's Google for the world's private communications. And they can just go into your emails, your phone calls, it's all stored. And now with keywords, search into that database, and the computer tells you what to look at. It data mines. It's just so incredibly evil, and the London Guardian has an article breaking it down. Now, Chris worked in the military, he said, in classified areas, and he was getting into a comment on the NSA. What were you specifically talking about? Sir, go ahead.
Tempest. I was talking about Tempest.
And how do you spell that?
T-E-M-P-E-S-T. Like a storm?
Sure, Tempest. Tempest certification
it's
program.
It's code.
Okay, go ahead.
All right, well, basically, they protect computers with a copper shielding and a SCIF. a secure control intelligence facility, which the secure controlled intelligence facility has, like, walls at a certain degree. I can't give you the classified information. Like, they have ultra frequency and they have ELF, which we saw that guy that killed somebody for extremely low frequencies on his weapon.
Yes.
But I can't give you the actual frequency because that would be classified if I remembered it accurately. But point being is that they're trying. Well, I don't know if they're trying to. But my point, my whole argument was, is that we have scientists who have already mapped the human brain.
Yes.
And we have scientists who have actually, through microwave principles, which I know about through the NSA, and they've already sent that microwave principle through satellites.
DARPA was in the Baltimore Sun about 16 years ago. I covered it like 20 times, literally, admitting that they were practicing with cell towers to, quote, calm the public. And I remember just reading that, and it was a trial balloon, just a test. And I do know that every major university facility that I've talked to has huge classified DARPA programs testing different ways to mesmerize the human brain, to shoot carrier waves out through the television, ultra-low frequency, you name it. So, yes, there's major mind control going on. They've got, quote, new anti-stress vaccines. They give, quote, PTSD trips that literally eat part of the brain. It's a lobotomy, but they just don't tell you that. It's not as severe, but it destroys high emotions. So we are not in Kansas anymore, and they're just calmly rolling out something from a body snatcher movie, basically. I mean, we're living in crazy times. It's so exciting. In a way, it's exhilarating. I mean, it's horrifying at the same time. I have children, but the public talks about being bored, and then everybody wants me to go see a football game or, you know, a rock concert. I mean, I'm sorry, nothing compares to reality. And so much of the fake culture we live in is not real culture. It's not real stuff that's going on. God bless you. I appreciate your call. Paul, if you hold, I'll get to you. Ronnie and James and Mike and others. I haven't even really hit a lot of the news yet. But I think the big news is we're in a brain damage trance. We're totally bankrupt. We're physically degenerating. We need to admit we're in a nosedive to pull up out of it. And I'm here in the cockpit screaming at the pilots. That's the American people. Hopefully, you know, to get control of the stick and pull this baby up. And we're like falling from 30,000, 20,000, 10,000 feet. We're about 2,000 feet right now. We need to pull up. More signing statements, more executive orders, more secret executive orders, secrecy on lobbyists, just incredible amounts of secrecy and lying. Michelle Obama has now come out. We're going to play the video after our guest leaves us. And said that they're super transparent because you can now take selfies at the White House. So that's the type of gimmick they're engaging in. Meanwhile, Oregon launches program to tax drivers by the mile. Isn't that just a special? Greek bank are in trouble and are closed, and they're now down to 500 million euros in cash. They're now limiting people to 20 euros a day that they can get out. Simply incredible. Obama administration has scaled back deportations in policy shift. They stopped deportations about a year and a half ago. They first denied that. Now they go, yeah, we're doing it, including felons, aggravated felons. It's no wonder Rasmussen has a poll showing massive support growing for states to ignore federal courts. And I mentioned this earlier. It's simply unbelievable. A judge has ordered a gag order on the group that got sued for not making the gay cake, the gay marriage cake. And he's now put a gag order out saying they can't speak to the media. So this is tyranny, ladies and gentlemen. And look, I'm a libertarian. I don't even get into these issues. But they've turned the whole transgender gay lesbian movement into a tyranny to destroy free speech. I mean, if you don't agree with somebody, that's fine. You can disagree with them. You can't shut them up. And if they can do it on this, they can do it on anything. And I mean, now they're trying to make laws in Europe where you can't criticize the central banks. Or you can't criticize EU bureaucrats who exempt themselves from the high taxes. Joining us, he'll be joining us every few weeks. I'm excited to be able to have him on as a regular guest. Peter Schiff, Europac.net, manages billions successfully at Europac.net. An American businessman, best-selling author, and his dad's also a famous patriot fighting the IRS. And he's the host, of course, of the Peter Schiff Show as well. And he's a frequent guest on financial television programs, and generally one of the lone voices of sanity. He'll have four or five other pundits saying everything's wonderful, and he'll be on there giving his contrarian view, like the fact that Greece cannot be bailed out no matter how many times they do it, and that more countries and areas are to come. And now, since he was on with us a few weeks ago, Puerto Rico has announced that they're insolvent. Well, I mean, guess what? Basically everybody is, except maybe Switzerland. In fact, that's a good question, a good place to start with Peter Schiff here today. Peter, what are the best countries in the world right now? And then let's get into Greece. Let's get into this jobs report.
Yeah, well, Switzerland is pretty good. They have made some mistakes in kind of pegging the Swiss franc to the euro. They gave that up, but they're still intervening to prevent their currency from rising. But there are countries around the world. Singapore is another good example, maybe New Zealand. I mean, there's a handful of places that we invest our clients' money in over at Europe Pacific Capital. And by the way, now we're europac.com. I mean, .net still works, but now I've got the .com URL as well. But, you know, it's hard to find the countries that aren't completely screwed up. I mean, most of them are broke. The irony, right? Puerto Rico is claiming that it can't pay its debts, which is true. But Puerto Rico's debt to GDP is much lower than America's debt to GDP. So we're broke too. The only difference is there's no QE program for Puerto Rico. The Fed is not buying Puerto Rican government bonds. So interest rates have already risen in Puerto Rico, and that's why they can't pay. But if interest rates ever rise in the United States, we are even more broke than they are.
Now, the Fed keeps saying for years that, oh, we're going to get around to it soon, but they don't. What happens if they do? What happens if they don't?
Well, we're damned if they do and we're damned if they don't, right? If they do raise interest rates, they prick the bubble that they inflated, right? Because we have so much debt. The only reason the bubble hasn't already burst is because rates are still at zero. So if they move them back up to even 2 or 3%, which is still historically very low, given how much debt we have, it is impossible to sustain it. The federal government doesn't have the money, corporate America, homeowners, everybody is so levered up that if interest rates go up, we're Greece, we're Puerto Rico. Now, if they keep interest rates at zero indefinitely because they're afraid of causing a financial crisis, eventually the world will catch on. I mean, they haven't done it yet, but eventually they will. And then the bottom drops out of the dollar and we have a dollar crisis, which I think is the worst possible outcome. But unfortunately, it's the most probable.
So many pundits now are starting to agree with you more. Before, they said everything's perfect, it can go on forever. We are hearing a lot more noises that the big one is coming. Ron Paul was on yesterday. For the first time interviewing him for 20 years, he said he thinks it's getting really close. I know they can still engage in some manipulations to keep this dog and pony show going, but it seems the writing is on the wall that we're getting close here.
Yeah, unfortunately, most people can't read plain English. You know, it is there for anybody who can care to take the time to read it. But most people want to deny it. I mean, hopefully we can have Ron Paul's son in the White House when it hits the fan, because the real fear is we have another one of these big government types, even from the Republican Party, who are instinctively going to react to this next crisis exactly the way we reacted to the last one. More government stimulus, more money printing, and that's just going to lead to an even bigger disaster.
What about this jobs report?
Yeah, you know, they ought to call it the lack of jobs report, but, you know, on the surface, everything is great, right? We created 220,000 jobs, but, you know, what they don't really talk about on the network news is, well, number one, they reduced the previous estimate 2 months by 60,000 jobs. So they weren't as good. The reports weren't as good as they originally told us. But if you look beneath the surface, the unemployment rate dropped to 5.3. But it's because, 600,000 people left the labor force. It was a mass exodus. The labor force participation rate plunged to 62.6. That's the lowest rate since 1977. And these are not older people who are retiring. These are 20 to 30-year-old guys who are leaving the labor force. I mean, they're not retired. They're unemployed, but they're not counted as unemployed because they're no longer part of the statistics. So it looks like the numbers are good, but they're awful. Meanwhile, the people who do have jobs, these are part-time jobs. Again, another month where we destroyed full-time jobs and replaced them with lower-paying part-time jobs.
Well, anybody who's got friends and family knows that on average, people are doing a lot worse than they were 20 years ago, 10 years ago. Most of the country looks like it was bombed out or something. There's still selectively some good areas in the economy, but I just can't imagine what it's going to look like when things do go belly up. Let's specifically talk about Greece and the, quote, contagion. My issue is, no matter how many times they get bailed out, it's going nowhere. And now the IMF and the World Bank and the EU, the Troika, they want them to put higher taxes on their tourism and stuff that's already really high. That'll just stall the economy more.
Yeah, look, it can't work. You have to admit the obvious that Greece is broke, and trying to come up with ways to pretend that they can pay the money back isn't going to work. They never should have bailed them out the first time. All this is kicking a can down the road. But, you know, eventually you run out of road, and that's really where we are when it comes to Greece. Everybody has to admit that the debt cannot be repaid. But also, all the bailouts are meant to bail out the politicians. Greece has to change. Greece has to level with their citizens that they can't get something from nothing, that they've run out of other people's money, and that people have to actually get legitimate jobs. They just can't collect checks from the government. They can't be overpaid. They need a market-based economy. But all the bailouts perpetuate is the socialism that has ruined Greece.
You know, I went back last week after we talked and did some research on the Greek economy, and it's not been doing good for over 100 years. But at their best points, 30, 40 years ago, they had some industry, they had lower taxes, and they weren't as socialist. But you're right. Government wants people dependent, and big corporations on average want to be able to get government contracts and have government shut down their competition, so they go along with big government. But then it creates just a giant mass of people that want more, more, more. And then this time when stuff collapses, they're not going to know how to work. What's going to happen?
Yeah, look, you know, there's one industry in Greece that is thriving, and that's shipping. And the reason that Greek shipping is such a good industry is because by law, the Greek government can't tax it.
Right.
So they exempted one industry from taxation, and it's thriving. Why don't they do that with all their industries? Why don't they get the government out of the entire economy? Because they kept the government out of shipping, and they dominate global shipping.
And that's because an insider 80-something years ago got that law passed so he could base a shipping company there.
Yeah, but of course, that's what you want to do. You want to base your company. Why did I move my business to Puerto Rico, my asset management company? You know, people joke, you know, about me, say, hey, Peter, you told us to go to Puerto Rico, and now look at the problems. I didn't tell anybody to buy Puerto Rican bonds. I specifically told people not to. I don't own any Puerto Rican bonds, but I do have a business there because my tax rate is only 4%, and then my capital gains tax is zero. So I want to do business in Puerto Rico, but I'm not going to lend money to the Puerto Rican government because I know they're broke. But, you know, if they actually default and restructure their debt, that's going to be good for the Puerto Rican economy because they'll get out from under this debt trap. But we're the ones that ensnared them in it. We're the ones that enticed them into borrowing all this money in the first place. And we screwed up their economy with the Jones Act, which forces them to use overpriced U.S. ships to trade through. And we have the minimum wage. And, you know, for anybody who's excited about a $15 an hour minimum wage, we destroyed the Puerto Rican economy by forcing them to adopt our minimum wage. So you have wages in Puerto Rico that are relatively 50% of wages on the mainland, yet they have the same minimum wage. And that $7.25 minimum wage is effectively 15%, which is why the labor force participation rate in Puerto Rico is just 42%. You got more than 20% unemployment, and that is what the United States is going to look like if we adopted a $15 minimum wage nationwide, which is what people like Bernie Sanders wants to do. But those idiots out in California already did it in Los Angeles. So they're going to turn Los Angeles into Puerto Rico.
Well, it was Aristotle, Onassis, and others that got Greece to build its shipping industry basically out of nothing, and they lobbied to, you know, get those laws in place before World War II, but also again after the Germans were kicked out, and it made them the center of Mediterranean shipping. And now a bunch of wealth redistributors at The Guardian and others are basically calling to get rid of the tax exemption for people that moor their boats there, not realizing how much money all these people and these companies and these yachts are bringing in. It just shows the complete idiocy. Look at California, totally bankrupt, getting more bankrupt every day, and now they've passed forced inoculation laws. They're just total tyrants. Where do you expect when the dominoes start going down? And I know it varies hundreds of different ways, but in the U.S., after Puerto Rico goes down, whether it's this year, next year, whenever, what's next? California? Yeah. I mean, we know Michigan already went under.
Yeah, well, first of all, you know, Alex, you know, any idiot can redistribute wealth. The hard part is to create the wealth in the first place. And the redistributors simply get in the way of wealth creation. That's what benefits people, right? Not somebody that's trying to steal money and spread the wealth around. It's the people that create something out of nothing. The entrepreneurs, the businessmen that figure out how to satisfy human unlimited desires with limited resources, and they give people the things that they want at lower and lower prices. That's capitalism, that's freedom, and government works to undermine this.
And but, how you know, can people arrogantly demonize it when anyone who studies history knows? I'll tell you why. We went out and talked to UT students. 6 out of 10 had no idea what July 4th even is, or Independence Day is. And of the 4 that did, only 2 had a good idea. In California, we had a reporter go out, Mark Dyson, do it. And it was even worse. 8 out of 10 had no idea and thought it was secession from the South. I mean, look, well, I know you're an optimist about, you know, things getting better once we have a correction. But what do you do with some of the dumbest, laziest people the world's ever seen?
Well, that's the problem. All those dumb, lazy people are voting, you know, and that's, you know, that's part of the failure. We used to be a republic and now we're a democracy, and that is a big problem. And our founding fathers, when this nation was first conceived, it was conceived as a republic by people who understand the evils of democracy. And unfortunately, their worst fears have been realized, which is why, you know, I always celebrate the 4th of July with mixed emotions. I love the idea of the holiday and what we commemorate. Right. But it also makes me reflect on what we've lost.
Oh, I agree.
Because this country is nothing like it was. And we are now oppressed by our own government to a degree that King George in England never could have conceived. And our founding fathers, were they able to look into the future and see the lives that we're living today, they never would have fought the revolution. They would have stayed with the king. But I want to get back to your earlier point about, you know, when is this going to happen? I think, you know, the dominoes are falling, you know, Greece, Puerto Rico, you know, the countries that have borrowed too much, right, are being held accountable. The chickens are coming home to roost.
What's next,
Spain? And we got more chickens out there than anybody.
What's next, Spain? I mean, what do you see next?
Well, I'm more worried about the United States.
Really?
Because we're the biggest debtor. And right now, people worrying about Spain or Portugal are loaning more money to us, even though we're more indebted than Spain or Portugal. That's how broke we are. The only thing keeping us afloat is the illusion of economic health and the fact that we have these 0% interest rates. But that illusion is going to be pierced. It's like, you know, a mirage out in the desert. I mean, eventually you get to the mirage and you realize that there's nothing there, right? You reach for the water and you got a handful of sand and, you know, you can't drink that. I think the day of reckoning is coming. I think people have to prepare for it. You know, your listeners are preparing for it. Prepare for it like it's going to happen tomorrow. And if you're lucky, it won't. But at least you're prepared. You got to get out of Dodge. You got to get your money out of dollars, you know, out of, you know, U.S. financial assets. We talked earlier about the countries that are not making these mistakes. There are solvent countries that are loaning all the money that everybody else is borrowing, that are producing all the goods that everybody else consumes. There are countries that still have relative freedom on an economic sense. I'm not talking about a political sense.
Sure. Tell us who's really good, and then what about the dragon? What about China? Is it a basket case?
No, it's not. I mean, look, you know, we got lots of political freedom, right? You can go out and complain all you want in the United States, but do you have real economic freedom? Absolutely not. The government controls you. We have a command economy, a centrally planned economy. I feel that every day as an entrepreneur here. The weight of government is very heavy on my business. I know that in places like China, there is a lot more free market capitalism going on beneath the surface in communist China than there is in supposedly capitalist America. You know, they have a bad monetary policy. They're printing too much money to prop up the dollar. But look, go to Walmart. Go look at all these products. Look at where they're made. How did they make them in China? They have to have factories. They have to have machines. They have to have skilled laborers, right? All we do is print money. What does that take? Nothing. In fact, most of it isn't even printed. It lives electronically, in a cyberspace.
Isn't it really a Mexican standoff, though? Because we've got nuclear weapons. They've got it. They're our second biggest owner of the debt after the Federal Reserve. And they know that if we go under, they go under. And if they go under, we go under. So we're both propping each other up. But the house of cards is starting to wobble.
I don't think that's true. I think if we go under, they prosper. See, I think it's not a symbiotic relationship, but more of a parasitic one. They just haven't figured it out that we're the parasite and they're the host, because it's a one-way relationship. They keep lending us money that we can never pay back, mm-hmm. and they keep giving us products that we can't afford. I mean, why don't the Chinese keep their own money, invest it in their own economy instead of buying our treasuries? And why don't the Chinese citizens consume their own goods?
By the way, that's a good point. People love to demonize China because their goods flood everything, and a lot of them are cruddy. But at the same time, we're the ones buying cruddy products that break. Yeah. We're the ones buying Chinese products. And we're the ones buying real goods with fiat dollars. So it just goes to say we'd get a bunch of stuff that breaks before you get it out of the box. Because we're buying it with imaginary confetti.
Look, the Chinese products are not junk. I mean, if they were junk, people wouldn't buy them. The reason that so many people want Chinese products is because they're not junk. You know, we used to make those great products. We used to be the manufacturers of the lowest cost goods in the world. That's what America did. We mass produced high quality, low cost goods. The high cost stuff was made in Europe.
Yeah, we used to be China. You're right. Stuff. We used to be known for good. I mean, I don't think Chinese goods are as good as Americans, say, in the 50s, but I do get your point that they have a lot of great products, but the toys and other knickknacks and stuff, I mean, they break really fast.
Right, but what toys do we make? I mean, if my kid had to play with American-made toys, he'd have no toys. He'd have nothing to play with except, you know, things around the house.
No, so I hear you.
The only reason our kids have toys is because the Chinese make them. If we had to make the toys, only the rich kids would get toys. The fact that the middle class has anything is because we get it from China. But all those days are going to come to an end when the Chinese come to their senses and stop buying our treasuries and let the dollar tank, which is why your listeners, my clients, need to be prepared now. That's what we're doing, getting people out of their dollars, buying quality stocks and bonds and hard assets around the world in advance of this day of reckoning, which I think is, you know, around the corner.
Well, like you said, if you're in Greece or all these other countries, it's already here. Look at the Middle East collapsing, Africa collapsing, Latin America's collapsing. Look at Venezuela. Look at wealth redistribution there now. It is in full collapse.
Yeah, and think of it. Remember when the real estate bubble first burst and it started out in subprime and they said, oh, don't worry about it. It's contained to subprime. Yeah, it wasn't contained at all, right? It was all over the mortgage market. So we're seeing these problems in places like Puerto Rico or Greece. It's not contained to those countries. All the countries that have borrowed too much money that they can't afford are going to have to be held accountable for what they've done. Just like all the mortgages, even if you had good credit, if you borrowed more than you could afford to repay, you know, you still lost your house.
Sure. What state's in the most trouble, Illinois or California? I mean, we know Michigan is essentially a beautiful state, but has fallen apart.
Oh, and it's not just the states. It's the cities, the municipalities, and it's the federal government. I mean, we got problems on top of problems. The only thing keeping all these cities and states afloat is the fact that interest rates are at zero. See, I think before the dollar collapses, the Federal Reserve is going to launch QE4. It's going to expand its asset purchases, and the Federal Reserve is going to be not only buying U.S. treasuries, but state bonds as well. Who knows? They might even end up buying the ones in Puerto Rico, but they're going to buy California bonds.
They might start buying hamburgers.
Bonds, they'll buy Connecticut bonds.
They might start buying hamburgers from McDonald's to prop them up.
Well, you know, although McDonald's has been having a tough time, if you look at their earnings, even the McDonald's customers are too poor to shop there. I mean, the real American businesses are struggling. You know, people are wondering, why are Americans not spending? Because they're broke. Because they borrowed too much money to buy stuff in
Peter,
the past.
I know you got to go, but
money to buy stuff now.
Do five more minutes with us on the other side if you can on the election. Right. I want to come back and talk about the election with you, and then we're going to get to your phone calls. Everybody that's holding, Paul, Ronnie, James, Mike, Adam, and others. Our guest, you can go to his website, Europac.com or Europac.net, and check out a lot of the interesting information that's right there. He's going to be leaving us here in a few minutes, and I will go directly to your phone calls that have been patiently holding. I am your host, Alex Jones. If you just tuned in, we are live. I'll be live this Sunday as well 4 to 6 p.m. So thank you for tuning into the Friday broadcast. We'll know a lot more after this vote on whether the Greeks are going to pay the debt or not. Either way, the euro is in deep trouble, in my view. But again, the United States is in deep trouble as well, but we're in this Alice in Wonderland situation. Peter, you got cut off by the break. I just wanted to ask you about the election and where it's going. Of all the candidates, who do you like the best?
But yeah, you know, even if the Greeks vote to pay the debt, they're just voting to pretend to pay the debt because they will never pay that debt. They're just going to go deeper into debt. But yeah, you know, I like Rand Paul. I mean, I've been a big supporter of both Ron Paul and now Rand. I, you know, was supporting him when he ran for Senate.
You were his dad's financial advisor.
I was officially an economic advisor to the 2008 campaign, not the 2012 campaign, but the first campaign for president as a Republican was 08, and I was an economic advisor there. But I supported Rand when he ran in 2010. I ran unsuccessfully in the same year in Connecticut. He ran in a more friendly state, Kentucky, and he's in the U.S. Senate now, and I think he's done a good job. But more importantly, you know, I trust his understanding, and I trust his commitment and his integrity to hold true to his principles in a crisis. And I think a crisis is coming, and he's a guy that we really want to have, you know, at the helm of this ship when we hit the iceberg. You know, because most of the other candidates have no idea what to do, and they'll just sink it. You know, so having Rand there, I think, would be very, very important. So I wholeheartedly support.
Sure, I mean, look at Donald Trump. That's the big story the last few days. And look, I think Donald Trump's in there for publicity. I think Donald Trump will drop out at an opportune time, hand it over to Jeb. I think that's what his job is. But a lot of what he says is absolutely true. I mean, I like the statements that come out of Donald Trump's mouth overall. And he's an interesting guy. I mean, I'm not an enemy of the guy. I just know he's an establishment, you know, shill.
No, I agree with you that, you know, and I've met him a couple of times, but I don't really know him. But, you know, a lot of the stuff that he says, I agree with. I mean, some of the stuff I totally disagree with, but he says a lot of things that other people are afraid to say because, you know, they actually want to get the nomination. And so they can't say these things. But if he can have a lot more fun because he can speak his mind, he can speak freely. And a lot of people are going to be turned on by that. But of course, a lot of people are going to get turned off. And it, you know, obviously makes it very difficult for him to actually win. But I agree, you know, I think he's going to enjoy being in on this. He's going to enjoy this.
Well, that's why I raised this, because AP has the headline, Hispanic leaders want GOP leadership to condemn Donald Trump's idiocy. We're not saying that Mexicans are all criminals. What we're saying is from all over the world, criminals run here because they can operate under aliases, and then we're a giant dumping ground now for moms with kids, women to come here to have babies from all over the world. CNN advertises, you know, how Chinese women are now the biggest immigrant group to come here to have their babies.
Yeah,
like it's a good thing.
And Alex, I feel sorry for those babies. Their mothers are sticking them with U.S. citizenship. That's a curse now. I mean, the U.S. government's going to tax them for the rest of their lives, no matter where they live. I mean, they're better off with a Chinese passport than an American passport.
No, I get your point, but I mean, it's just pure craziness that he tells the truth that we're now the point of, you know, travel for criminals. He points it out. It's all over the news, the numbers. I mean, where they let 36,000 felons in the last year.
The point that Trump was making, he was saying, when he's talking about people coming across the Mexican border, he is not just talking about Mexicans. It's everybody else that makes their way into this country through that porous border. So he's not saying Mexicans as a people. It's just anybody that comes across.
Oh, I know. Said that, and it's clear what he said, and it's true. But they spin everything like, you're against Obamacare. You're racist. You don't want to turn your guns in. You're racist. I mean, how far can this political and correct garbage go?
Look, yeah. Look, why don't we just elect Caitlyn Jenner as president just to prove how tolerant we are? You know, that will show that we're tolerant, not homophobic or racist. But, you know, but I don't blame our nation's problems on immigrants. You know, I mean, if we had a free market, we didn't have a welfare state, I say anybody who wants to come, come in.
I agree.
Come in and work. But it's the welfare state that's the problem. It's the war on drugs that's the problem. If we had a real free market, look, all four of my grandparents came to this country as immigrants, but they had no welfare, they had no food stamps, they had no Obamacare, they had no minimum wage. All they came for was freedom, and that's all they got. They didn't get any help from the government. They just got left alone by the government.
And let me guess, I bet they became successful.
Yes. I mean, they didn't become rich, but they had better lives than they would have had had they stayed in Eastern Europe where they had plenty of government.
Well, it's just fantastical to see how far this house of cards can be built. It's like Yertle the Turtle. But at some point, a gasket's going to blow, and I think we see the rumblings of that now. Well, Peter Schiff, thank you so much for joining us. Look forward to speaking to you again.
Looking forward to it. Remember, the first and the third Friday of every month, I'll be a guest on your show. Looking forward to
it. I'm super excited. Thank you so much for coming on with us. And next time he's on, we'll take phone calls for him. I know you've been holding forever, so I'm going to go to Paul and Ronnie and Mike and James and Adam. I apologize you've been holding so long. Usually what talk shows do, though, is they just hang up on everybody once a guest comes on and then get new calls. But so it's kind of a nice thing I do, but then I kind of feel bad about it. So thank you for holding. I'm going to go to you. I'm going to run through some of the headlines we haven't hit yet. General Secretary of Communist Vietnam invited to the White House to push the TPP. They get to see it, but nobody else does. Truly insane. Also, the video that we played at the start of the show is on Infowars.com. In Austin, Austinites are almost as ignorant as Californians about Independence Day. And see, that's why MSNBC and CNN talk about how smart liberals are all day and how well-educated they are. Well, yeah, you go get 5, 6, 7 degrees because you can keep getting loans to get more degrees. And then when you're 57, you go to work at the grocery store. I understand how that works. Or, you know, how many housewives don't see it as honorable to raise 2 or 3 kids and take care of them, so they go off and get 5 or 6 degrees that they never use. And, you know, and then the husband, and then they divorce the husband when he's 50 and he has a heart attack or whatever. I mean, I understand how all this works, but we always go to universities. If you really want to show the dumbest people on the planet in liberal areas or trendy areas. The problem is if you go to a trendy area, the Democrat area, they can't talk. Black, white, I don't care. I mean, they can hardly have utterances. So that video is up there on the site. Just frighteningly stupid. And they hate your house. They hate your car. They hate your truck. They hate your short haircut. And look, you want to have long hair? I don't care. It's not like I'm sitting there going, look at that long hair, boy. I mean, you want to get down to brass tacks. I basically had a mohawk when I was 15. It's that you're obsessed with it, and that's all you've got is your fill in the blank. I mean, you've got these people that think they know it all that wear polo shirts and, you know, have golf clubs in the back of their car, don't even play golf. They just want to look cool. It's posers I don't like. I don't care what color you are or what your style is or what you do or, you know, whatever it is. It's just that you're so stupid. You're a nobody. And so you just take on a cult, and you're a Democrat, and you support Obama because you're not racist like me. And then you just project onto me that I'm a failure and I'm bad and you're good. And what you are is an idiot. See, as soon as I start thinking about the people that don't know what the Declaration of Independence is, excuse me, they don't know what Independence Day or the 4th of July is. It's frightening. And I've got them going out next week to go to a blue-collar industrial area. And I guarantee you 9 out of 10 people are going to know. So working-class blue-collar people, middle-class hardworking folks, rich people, they all know what is going on. You go, though, to the millennials or to trendies, and I mean, they don't know anything but how to act cool. And how are we going to build a country on that? Now, let's be clear. I had Ron Paul on yesterday. He's the hottest thing when he goes still to a university. 5,000, 10,000, 20,000 come out. He goes to other countries, the same thing happens. And it's young people of every race, color, and creed. It's a beautiful thing to see. I haven't done this in years. I spoke at UT with like no announcement and 2,000 people showed up. We ought to do that again. When I spoke in the big UT, whatever that big giant hall is at Olds 2000, they turned away like 1,000 outside with no promotion. Freedom is popular. So you either got young people that are the most awake, the most active, the most dynamic. I saw a young lady selling peaches yesterday. And I pulled over and got some peaches. I gave some friends for a party they're putting on. They're going to put the peaches in sangria. I didn't know that. I just thought, here's some peaches for your party. And they said, well, that's perfect. We'll put the sangria. Fredericksburg peaches. And I walk over and she goes, you're Alex Jones. And she goes, I changed my major to RTF from economics because of your show. My dad's a huge listener. On and on and on. It's not the old classic thing of the old guy going, these dumb kids listen to music I don't like. That rock and roller. I don't like that Elvis Presley. It's not that. It's that we go out and talk to the public, and people below the age of 30 do not know what planet they're on. And by the way, it's older folks, too. Like the woman that thought that, let's go to your phone calls. It's just, she thought that 1776 was when we seceded from the South. Because there's no way England could have been the enemy, because all we hear is how great the royalty is and how wonderful England is all day. It is a really cool country. Too bad socialists run it. Paul in Connecticut, thanks for holding. You're a trooper. You're on the air on this Friday edition, July 3rd.
Thanks, Colin, from FEMA Region 1. I want to talk about the 4th of July. It's about universal truth. It's about freedom from tyrants and lies. And although we are growing, I'll tell you what, we'll be the last people standing after everything else shuts down.
Well, that's the crazy part is it will be the patriots that have got the food, got the guns, and know how to skin a buck and run a trot line. I'm just worried about the zombos literally eating us. You know, first they'll steal our food and everything. The problem is they're not going to have guns or know how to use them. So what you're going to have is a lot of dead trendies.
We have a lot of arrested developmental government-trained individuals out there, but they're going to catch on fast when it gets difficult. And this is the only thing. They're going to learn from the school of hard knocks, and we're going to have to be there as an example for them like we are right now.
You're really well-spoken, sir. Anything else you'd like to add?
I just want to say that we're winning.
I think we are winning. And when it comes to intellectuals and folks that are informed, anti-New World Order is the hottest thing since sliced bread. It just gets hotter. It's the hottest thing since thumbs. I mean, it really works good. And it's the truth. I mean, free market, its only problem is it creates so much wealth and so much choice. It's destructive and decadent, and it is wasteful. But tyranny is much more destructive, wasteful, and tyrannical than freedom. I mean, there's just no comparison. And you've got all these idiots in the lap of luxury, never working for anything, mad because somebody that does work has something nice. And they're just so stupid. Wealth is like a coral reef in the middle of the ocean. That's what creates the basis of more life. It's like cities. People complain about traffic. They complain about too many people. But you live here because there's jobs. More people gives you jobs. But if we don't have 2.1 children, then there's not enough people to continue on. You have to have replacement rate, and we don't. So a collapse is coming, the demographic cliff. Let's talk to James in Colorado. Thanks for holding. What does July 4th mean to you?
Alex, hey, well, it's about not negotiating with terrorists and violent radicals. What we're doing, there's a Stars and Stripes article about the July 4th celebration canceled at UK, U.S. Air Force bases. They just say we apologize for any inconvenience. It's like there's not going to be a civil rights lawsuit over all of it. It's just going to be...
Excuse me, did you say that they just stopped 4th of July celebrations in the UK?
At U.S. Air Force bases, right.
Because it would have been hurtful? It would have been hurtful to the Brits?
They said due to threat assessments, I mean, it's part of our culture, so...
That's giving in to terrorism right there.
Exactly.
Huh? Hold on. What's the headline on that? I'm skipping this break, too. I can't help it. I've got to have more time. Are you telling me it's in Stars and Stripes? Guys, Google that. 4th of July celebrations canceled at UK Air Force bases. There it is. NBC News. I love it. No, the real reason is because we've been Anglophiled. We're being turned into a UK British government worship country where you'd think we're back with England again if you watch the propaganda. July 4th celebrations canceled at U.S. Air Force Base in the UK over terrorist attacks. So now, because the terrorists might attack, how about we just don't have any kids and all kill ourselves because it's so scary a terrorist might attack? I mean, they've trained most of the ISIS terrorists in England out of any country, and well, Saudi Arabia and the Middle East is more, but out of any European country, and then they're sending them in there. They've attacked France, and so now there can't be a 4th of July because a jihadi might attack. I mean, talk about the headline should be U.S. runs up white flag, cancels 4th of July. I mean, that is just insane. But don't you see right through that? I bet they never bring it back. It's about not having 4th of July celebrated in England.
Well, then after they ban the flags, they'll try to ban states' rights, tying it to the South, the seceding, saying it's inherently racist, have states' rights, have states at all. It's against globalism. Isn't friendly.
Oh, listen, you're not joking. 3 years ago, 4 years ago, it came out in the BBC and others, and it was buried in the article why they did it, but I knew as soon as I saw it that national team names are to be banned, I think they said by 2020. Search that. European national teams' names to be removed, to be changed. I forget the exact headline. Because nationalism is bad and racist, and so it's just going to be the names of different mythical creatures. So it won't be France, it won't be Spain, it won't be England, it won't be Greece, it won't be Portugal. It will just be different mythical creatures, because again, they have to get rid of the nation state and any memory of it. And soon you'll be talking to kids and saying, do you remember the USA? And they go, what's that, a racist thing? That thing they banned? I mean, this is mind control. This is a culture falling apart. God bless you. I guarantee you that was done to demoralize the military, to break it down, to get people out, to bring in women to be the new commandos, and then don't worry, the robots are coming out in a few years. This is how they ruin the military. And you're like, but the military gave them their power. They're going to everything to be autonomous, the fighter jets, everything. They're not building a future for humans. It's already been decided. I know I've said that thousands of times. I'll say it again. Mike in South Carolina, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Alex Jones, first time caller. Appreciate everything you do.
Thank you, brother.
When you start up, man, I'll tell you what, it's like going to a Texas pig hunt with a slingshot. I will tell you that my breakfast, I came from Yorktown, Virginia, so I know a lot of the history of 1776. Cornwallis surrender there. You don't realize what freedom is until you don't have it anymore. And you also find out that this government, this whatever they call it, this is not our government. This does not represent America in any way, shape,
or form. It is a foreign consortium, just like TPP is a great example, totally that occupies the country. When I say our government's like Vichy France, that I mean that. And, of course, Vichy France was the collaborator government that stood down to the Nazis and helped them take over. I mean, we have an actual collaborator government. Go ahead.
You are correct. It's been completely wiped out, taken over. They don't represent any of us. So, therefore, anything that comes out of the Supreme Court justices, like this homosexual nonsense, they should have made allotment for people to stay in their closets. I mean, these perverts, predators, and they're destroying the moral compass of this country. It needs to be stopped, and it needs to be stopped very quickly. These people do not represent us. They represent a clan that has been taken, that we've been taken over. By the way, one more little thing about Peter Schiff, who was one of my favorite people to listen to. I'm glad you had him on there. That one of the keys to what he was talking about is when the interest rates start going up, that's your key that the spiral is starting. And Jesse Ventura, Alex Jones, you make sure he has a fund for people to put into, to make a contribution to. That man is going to blow the socks off the rest of this nonsense. We need people like him, people like you, people who are going to stand up and not be afraid to.
Well, God bless you, Mike. Thank you for your testimony on that. Look, I don't hate heterosexuals or homosexuals. I don't like homosexuals saying I can't use the word homosexual because it sounds scientific and they say it's hateful. This is about dominating and taking over culture. I don't like the pushing of it on kids. And it is true they have judges in Australia and the UK saying pedophilia is good and that now there's a legalized pedophilia. I mean, it just opens the door to polygamy, to everything else under the sun. And that's now happening. And I said, I bet that it was a black man or woman that did it, or an ADL type person, somebody associated with ADL, Southern Poverty Law Center. Black man arrested after admitting to posting racist signs outside black churches. Message on the signs included, black men beware, you are the target. And he did it to, again, just hype all this race crap up. Same thing George Soros is doing. And he would even get on the news beforehand and talk about it. So it's just the classic deal that the police investigate whoever calls in the arson first, because that's usually who did it. And almost every case has been fake. That's why that church shooting is very, very suspicious when you add it all up. He was on an amnesiac drug, you name it. I'm not saying there aren't racist and bad people out there, but he was arrested for creating and committing a bias-motivated crime. No, it's his First Amendment if it was done on a right-of-way. So see, right there, hidden in there, you're like, good, arrest him. Wait a minute. Somebody wants to stick swastikas up, they can. Just don't do it in somebody's yard. Another one said, this church works for the KKK. This church identified as the devil for the KKK. Just sounds like a nut. Every time I see a case where a white woman carves a thing on her back, or it says black guys did it, it turns out that she did it to herself. Black women do it, and say white guys rape her, it turns out it's made up. I mean, I read the news every day. I mean, I see this stuff every week for 20 years. Let's go to another caller. Adam in Colorado, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Hi, Alex. First-time caller.
Welcome.
I just wanted to thank you. I was just going to say, it kind of dovetails with what you were saying earlier about the ignorant people and how they sort of can't get mad at them. It's the awake people that don't do anything, and I think that's what 4th of July is about, is when the awake people get together and do something.
I agree. We should use July 4th as a day of activism to hang up signs, to talk to people, to get motivated, to go out to parades, to warn people, to hand out DVDs, to get aggressive. I can't tell you how many people tune into this show, and I'm going to keep doing Overdrive. I'm going to do a whole other segment to talk to Daniel and Wild and Ronnie and Julian. I'm going to go to Ronnie next. But great point, Adam. How do we get active? What do we do? I think everybody shouldn't interfere with commercial AM and FM stations. That everybody should get a hold of 1-watt transmitters or whatever at that power. You know, I doubt the FCC will regulatorily ever come after you. I believe it's legal and lawful. And hook it up to the internet and broadcast this show or others from an antenna for 5 or 6 square miles in the middle of a city. Put up signs everywhere. And you'll have thousands of people that end up tuning in to that little transmitter. It is so easy to get a hold of 1/4-watt. 0.5-watt, 1-watt transmitters. You can get an amplifier for a couple $100 and boost it to 10 watts. But you start doing that, you're going to end up with some FCC issues. But just find a spot on the dial that isn't being used. We're in an emergency. The globalists are taking over. The CIA used to ship hundreds of thousands of little 1-watt transmitters to folks all over the former Soviet Union and other countries to retransmit Voice of America. Well, we need a real Voice of America. And I've never really gotten on air and advocated people doing that because I don't want folks to have problems. I did talk about micro FM a lot, you know, 20 years ago, 15 years ago, but, you know, we would do whole shows on it so people understood the danger of it. But quite frankly, the greater danger is in doing nothing. And how it works is you get a warning the first time, and if you don't take it off, they then try to fine you $10,000. And that's the procedure. So really, you can say there is no risk from my research. Do your own and make your decision from doing it until you get a letter. I mean, I'll be honest. I know folks in East Texas and in West Texas that are in towns of more than 50,000 people that have been broadcasting this show for over a decade, and basically everyone listens and is awake. And we're talking with like 10 watts. You can educate an entire town, put up signs, And just never announce yourself, never say where it's coming from. It's like Fight Club. Well, Obama, in a provision of the TPP that's been leaked, refused, came out last week, to pressure them to have an anti-slavery clause in there that you can't have people basically chained up in sweatshops who are prisoners. And Obama pushed to make sure that wasn't in there while obsessing over the Confederate battle flag. And now the General Secretary of Communist Vietnam has been invited to the White House, slave labor gulag, instrumental in TPP vision of the future. And you're not going to hear a word out of all the liberal trendies on that. Very important article. I want to now go back to your calls. Daniel in FEMA Region 10, thank you so much for holding.
Alex, don't even bother thanking me. Listen, you just asked a really important question before the break. You said, what can we do? And it's great. Great segue into, but without cleaving to you with flatteries, I just want to say this and qualify where I've come from, or from where I've come, Viacom, Infinity Broadcasting. I worked on the number one radio show for 10 years in L.A. called the Tom Likas Show. And yes, I am a first-time caller, a long-time listener, and I want to tell you something. I've worked with the whole operation of the Survivor, original Survivor program, worked as a producer for many years. I want to say this. I would have never heard of you except for Dr. Scott Johnson from ContendingForTruth.com. 7 years now. I was 39 when I retired, and I woke up because of fractional reserve banking. I felt like a fool for not knowing that my money wasn't even backed by gold or anything. So I wanted to thank you, but I want to give you the solution, if you will.
You bet, brother. I'm all ears.
Well, I love your audience, number one. I listen to you every day, and I don't miss a beat unless I'm on my island in the Caribbean, which is my getaway. But I want to tell you this. The answer I have not heard from one single caller, and it's sad because you have a King James Bible-based audience that is like none other I've ever heard. And the audience people, I've been with all the big parties in L.A., with Tom Likas. I've met the most crude, disgusting people. I've heard people just fighting online, and even Tom Likas himself, the professor, was just slothful compared to you, my friend. You are, by far, your program is the most interesting thing on the internet, on the television, on the big screen, and I'm telling you what, keep it up, brother.
Well, thank you for the compliments. I mean, half the time I'm exhausted and incoherent, but our guests are amazing. We're just here trying to warn people about basic historical trends that are now really getting ready to break. All the crises we've seen so far is just a prelude. So what is the solution?
Cascade. It is what it is, but we have got to learn how to pray imprecatorily, using God's word. When I first found out about fractional reserve banking, I found out that my Bible was fake. I was reading an NIV or all these other translations. The King James Bible, the Word of God, is what the witches are afraid of. And I worked with the witches in Hollywood, my friend. I partied with the witches. And I know you constantly go on about who's who. Oh, you hung out with who. Oh, I could go on. Brother, you had Peter Schiff on, my friend. Keep him coming back.
By the way, let me throw something out here. Why didn't we have Larry Nichols on this Wednesday? He was supposed to be on this Wednesday to tell the witches' stories. And actually, Tex Mars dug up news articles of Hillary being blessed by a witch. And I saw in one other article years ago about her reportedly doing weird witchcraft stuff. And then I know Tony Blair's wife was heavy into Lucifer worship. The former leader over in the UK. So I know that's true, but I mean, Larry Nichols is the real deal. What he says is true. Why didn't we get Nichols on this week?
I'm not certain why Nichols wasn't on this week. Got to get with Nico.
Yeah, because he thought he was going to be back on. So let's try to get him on like next Wednesday or something, because he even plugged when he would be on. So we'll do that. I agree with you. We have a secular radio show, and that we're not a, quote, Christian radio show. But if you tune into the Christian radio shows, you really don't hear a lot about the New World Order and what's happening. Back in the 80s, you actually would. But they come after their licenses. They harass them. Look at what they did to the 700 Club. He was talking about the New World Order. Pat Robertson, then he finally shut up about that in the 90s. So there's a lot of issues there. But I agree with you. The Bible is the answer, not the misinterpretations of it, not the distortions, not the fake church set up by the devil that's calling for world government and all the rest of it. But the Bible itself, just the knowledge in it, just the common sense in it, is a great way to lead your life, even if you're not a Christian. And so you're absolutely right. I appreciate your call, Daniel. Good to hear from you. Let's talk to Wild in Wisconsin. You're on the air.
Happy 4th, Mr. Jones. There is a Serbian saying that goes, Jači smo od sudbine, which you should take into heart, which is, you are stronger than your destiny. But my question for you, especially after the last caller, not to get too meta on a Friday, but do you believe that the Old Testament God is also a tyrannical God?
The Old Testament God is the same God as the New Testament and will carry out judgments, generally allowing God removes the protection and then allows evil to come in and destroy you. So, yes, I believe the Bible.
You believe the Bible that he is or is not a tyrannical God?
I mean, I think there are Bible passages saying that God can be vicious, can be destructive, and that God hates evil people.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm not a total Bible scholar, but I wouldn't call it tyrannical, because tyrannical hurts innocent people. The reason
I bring it up is that it seems to me that if you look throughout history, that a concordant narrative always appears, at least in our recorded history, of the triumph of good and righteousness over evil. You see it in cinema, you see it in Aristotle's Poetics, you see it in numerous writings as far as they go back, even, you know, hieroglyphics and cave drawings showed that strife. And I always have difficulty, even after an NDE, in coping with the fact that it is kind of part of the system, this fight, and kind of exemplified by the times we're living in nowadays.
Well, good always wins because evil grows and grows and then collapses. So it's not even really that good wins. It's that evil doesn't work because it always ends up extinguishing almost all the good. And then everything collapses. And then the good grows back and fills the vacuum. Ron Paul talked about that yesterday. But what's an NDE?
Near-death experience.
Ah.
When you die and come back.
Well, everybody I've talked to, even people that aren't Christians that have died and come back, is the same story. And it's pretty powerful. Appreciate your call. God bless you. Ronnie in Texas, thanks for holding. You're on the air.
Thank you. Briefly, I happen to be one of those people, ironically. But anyway, what I called for is that...
This is Ronnie, who's been kicked out of the city council for free speech. And it was down there holding up a Ron Paul sign at the abortuary, and they physically attacked you. On video, kicking and attacking you for no reason, trying to violate your free speech while they screamed, Hail Satan.
You're right. I'm proud to be a patriot all these years. And largely, I'm thanking you for everything you do. But
dude, stop thanking me.
But
anyway, God, people, thank you.
Okay, I'm sorry. But the self-imposed lobotomy that's going on in our culture right now, I think it's reversible with joy because, like you also said earlier, sharing InfoWars is a good way to start, but prayer is always good. It's a good place to start, you know, with reading and writing and thinking. And my main point, though, is writing personal handwritten letters to friends, enemies, family, media, government. It's both therapeutic and good use for you.
I agree. Writing is really good. It helps your thoughts. Even if you don't believe in prayer, studies show it helps you get better. It's a high form of meditation, basically, and it's focusing inward and really being retrospective and then tying into the universe. Even if you don't believe in God, prayer is an awesome thing, and folks need to try it.
Focus is the key word there. I really appreciate your knowledge.
I tell you, it's scary. Ronnie, I want to hear what you think about 4th of July, but I'll tell you this in closing. I am scared to pray because my whole life God has answered my prayers, and it's very, very dramatic and very quick. And that's why I feel humble and pathetic, because I'm a wicked person. And God's had his hand on me my whole life, very, very closely. And I think for some ultimate mission, I don't know what it is quite yet, but I think it's going to be awesome. And I just hope that I am worthy of this. But everybody can have God's hand touch them if you've not been cut off from God. And I'm just so sad for people being taught that this isn't out there and happening, because it's what true fulfillment is. And we got 1 minute left, Ronnie, and I got to say sorry to Julian and Andrew. I'll be back to Sunday, Lord willing. But Ronnie, what does 4th of July mean to you?
Well, thank you. I wanted to say, yes, you're doing it right now. And that's a big part of it. I get to, celebrate it's more important to me now than it ever has been. The more I learn and study our Constitution and learn about Doctors Paul and our future of our political system, which is plausible. We have to work hard and move forward, but the men and women are out there who can lead our nation back to greatness. And
absolutely. Well, I mean, we know this. The parasites, it's easy to ruin stuff. It's easy for them to complain and do all the rest of it, but their system's coming down. We've got to just get ready and try to warn as many people as we can, and justice be done by the heavens fall. Great week. Great job, crew. I'll be back Sunday to kick off the new week that's going to be taking place. So this Sunday, 4 to 6 p.m., we'll be live in studio. Nightly News Tonight's going to be special. All right. So.